April 5th, 2016, the Board of Selectmen to order. We've got, you know, a pretty full and diverse agenda today, beyond the obvious that we always cover with liaison and public comment. We've got a proclamation this evening. We've also got some discussions around a letter of support. We will have two hearings tonight. One, the Recreation Committee is going to be joining us, and they'll be opening a public hearing relative to their recreation fees. We're going to be having some visits from the Reading Ice Arena and our CAB member from RMLD, the Housing Authority report. And then we'll be opening a second hearing that is going to be around traffic rules and regulations. The chief is going to be here with us tonight for that. We've also got a continued hearing that we're going to be opening towards the tail end of this meeting, and it has to do with our liquor license policy from the last meeting that we had relative to amendments and process going forward. So that being said, let's start with the liaison reports. Dan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I attended a meeting with Representative Jones called by the Reading Climate Advisory Committee over at the Pleasant Street Center on March 29th. It was very well attended, pretty diverse background of folks that were there. I think mostly, you know, I would say the mostly green types that were there. Couple of points covered by the representative. There are some important discussions happening on Beacon Hill regarding future power supply for the Commonwealth. Within the next 2 years, two major facilities will be closing, one being Brayton Point, which is down in Swansea. That's a large capacity. It's like 1,500 megawatts, and also Pilgrim Nuclear Power a couple of years later, I think. Brayton Point's going offline next year. So the net of that is going to be 2,000 megawatts of capacity dropping off our grid. And that sort of was part of the context of this meeting. What the state is considering to replace that base load is a combination of hydroelectric power imported primarily from Canada and offshore windmills. Okay, I'll have a little more to say about that in a minute. They did talk quite a bit about the solar bills that are going through. As you may be aware, there are a couple of compensating factors for folks that have solar power right now and want to put it on their roofs. One is they get a tax credit for the actual installation. The second is a thing called net metering, where they can actually sell the power back to the grid at a higher rate than the grid would charge regular customers. In other words, it's effectively recovering at their cost basis, the power. What the legislature has done, I think that the House passed this in the fall, they're actually lowering that amount they get back per kilowatt hour, which might render some future nuclear, solar power installations less economical. There was a general consensus in the room that solar is not going to play a major role here in the base load of the state, but it will have obvious applications in non-base loading. It seems to me that right now we have two very reliable, continuous, and affordable power sources. My concern is that, in part, the proposed plan replaces them with unreliable, intermittent, and expensive power. The Canadian Hydro is very reliable and very eco-friendly, but it could come at a higher cost because of the need to build power lines and that sort of thing. I did ask Brad a question about the offshore solar, given the history of Cape Wind and the fact that two utilities pulled out of that deal, which effectively doomed it because of the high cost per kilowatt hour. I got some general response back saying that, and Bob, you can chime in here because you were there too. There have been advances in technology. Europe is doing a lot of this, albeit with a lot of government subsidy. So I was a little concerned about that. Also, there was discussion about the Kinder Morgan pipeline. Not too many fans in the room there. It seems that I think Brad was more concerned about their manners with the communities that it's going through than the actual fact that it's bringing gas into the state. Gas, if you want to get your carbon footprint down, gas is probably the friendliest in terms of the traditional ways of generating power. So I was a little surprised that that's not playing a bigger role in the plan here. And I'm hoping, therefore, that the state takes a very hard look at this before it moves forward, especially with the offshore wind power.
Yes.
Was anyone from RMLD?
I don't believe so. There was someone there that used to work for RMLD.
Retiree, not current.
So yeah. were they invited to participate?
I don't know how wide the invitation went. There have been some differences in view between that committee and the RMLD in the past. So.
Okay.
A little surprising that they weren't represented.
Yeah.
Anyway.
It's a big decision, and it's one everybody should stay tuned to. And of course, it's being done behind closed doors. That was told us.
But there's no role for us as a,
You can write your representative or representatives and air your views. Anybody can do that.
But I mean, as a board?
Not directly.
Not yet.
Although we got involved with gas leaks, so.
Right.
Well, yeah, except that I do think we should clarify that. We got involved with gas leaks because there were 160 of them in Reading. I mean, our first look at that was, you know, let Beacon Hill do its work.
We kind of
rejected any discussion about being involved there. And then from there, it was brought to our attention actually by the Climate Committee.
Yeah.
That their research had shown that there were 160 of these situations exactly in Reading.
It's probably more of an admonition to the ratepayers
and
the people representing them, not so much us.
Well, I think that the committee probably sounds like they did a good job in, you know, getting a report from our local legislator. And
I'm glad he was well prepared, so we could know
what's going on.
Yeah, he had a lot of lot to say.
Doesn't sound like there's a lot for us to do though.
No, I'm not. It's not so much call to action by the board. Yes. But just FYI.
Reading has just a corner in the northeast that's conservation land that this pipeline is proposed to go through. And so the board has discussed this a year or more ago and basically had low interest compared to most communities that are on the path that have it going through houses.
Like Jacob, I think
this one? North Reading.
Well, I mean, when they brought the Tenneco pipeline through Reading, the manners were much better from the company. I mean, they have FERC to authorize it, and
Bob, I think you and I sat into that meeting with from that pipeline company. And I mean, honestly, it seemed like there was, I'm going to probably
Kinder Morgan,
exaggerate this, but it was like 100 yards in in the back corner of the conservation land that affected
Reading. And we talked to conservation right away, and they said, that's fine.
Yeah.
You know, we'll have rules and regulations they have to abide by, but that's not a problem. But most communities are extremely interested and involved. And the common thread of complaint is that the belief is this natural gas is all going to China. It has nothing to do with local use.
Which is not accurate.
That's not necessarily clear.
Yeah. Some of it will be going to district gas down in East Boston. I think that part is known. But.
So there's.
Well, we can't take advantage of the low price of gas because we can't get it here.
Well, yeah, so we should be supporting pipelines.
So I think the conclusion of Brad at that night, and I had met with him all the time, is the solution is no one thing. It's a combination of several things. And prices will change, technology will change, so if you have your hand in a bunch of different things, you have more flexibility.
Yeah, you'd be surprised to know what the biggest gas generating facility is in the state. Anybody know what it is? Mystic Generating Station on the Mystic River. You see it every day when you drive into Boston on the left. That's a gas-fired station now, over 2,000 megawatts.
You think there's a lot of gas coming out of Beacon Hill, Bob?
I'd say so.
Quite a bit.
It's possible.
Anyway, I've taken up more than my allotment, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Dan. Barry, anything to...
Just one thing really quick. You know, I was away last week, but I was invited, and I will participate with the trustees. They are, library trustees, they are trying to put together... sort of concerted fundraising plan for the library going forward. So we're starting to take that seriously, and I'll be participating as a selectman as they kind of work through some of the things to raise additional money for the building and the programs that will follow. So I'll keep folks surprised as I attend that.
Okay. Hey. Kevin?
I have nothing at this time, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. I was also away most of the time since our last meeting, but earlier this evening I was at a meeting of the Birch Benno Committee. There's been a lot of work from that committee that's been going on in the background. It's actually a subcommittee of the Recreation Committee. And I would say that at this point, there are two phases to the Birch Meadow project. One is in process, and that is the lighting of the, you know, of kind of the whole complex. And I wanted to report to you that it looks like we're starting to see the light of day a little bit on, you know, what's going on there. It's cleared certain hurdles for us to be able to actually, I believe I'm right to say, Bob, we're going to be going out for final bids now.
This month.
Yeah, which would, I think, point to construction in the summer.
Summer, fall, hard to say.
Yeah, but I'm guessing that phase one would be done before year end. I think it is fairly safe to say that. The scope of it, as you all remember, we listened to the Recreation Committee with an understanding that possibly all of the fields would not be, they had to set a priority order because possibly all of the fields might not get lit with the budget that they had. Encouraging news seems to be coming, you know, in that direction. I can't say that they're all going to get done, but it, you know, preparation costs were estimated at 150. They came in at 90. Borings, you know, could have presented a certain kind of foundational problem where it was going to be more expensive. They came in as inexpensively as possible as far as the foundations are concerned. So it's somewhat encouraging that, you know, we at least have a fighting chance to maybe get all of the fields lit, mm-hmm. even though there was a priority order. So right. I'll keep you posted as that moves along. And I would say that phase two is still some time away from presentation to town meeting, certainly not this town meeting coming up, but most of the areas have been examined and recommendations are finding their way back to the Recreation Committee for final presentation here and ultimately to town meeting. So a lot of progress going on in the background, you know, towards that recreational facility.
John, what's phase two include?
Phase two is so let's call phase one the lighting. Yeah. Phase two is things, for example, like a pavilion that families could use, has to do with plumbed bathrooms, has to do with, it has to do with the survey of how people wanted to use it that was recently revisited. Hiking trails, for example, all the way around the park were one of the things. So you've got all of those kinds of detail issues. Are you going to put a pickleball court over here or is it going to be a basketball court? Or, you know, what's going to happen where Imagination Station used to be because it's become a high demand parking lot, you know? And so those are all the issues that have been addressed, and they're kind of going after them one at a time, working their way around the actually. Any other questions about that?
That's good news.
Okay, keep you posted. I think it's encouraging news. It's not, I wouldn't
not quite
classify it as good news yet, but encouraging.
Better
news.
Than we had the last time, though.
Yeah, it is,
so
definitely. Bob, do you have some things for us?
Do you want to ask the public first?
Oh, I could do that. So we certainly want to open the floor to public comment, anything that wasn't necessarily planned for, but that you is on any of your minds that you'd like to talk about that's not on the agenda.
Oh, well.
Everybody's good for the moment?
Yes.
I'm sure it won't stay that way. Bob.
Thanks, John. First of all, we have a room full that we can thank. The last couple of weeks have been very challenging in public safety. And, you know, I can tell you as having a 10% view of what's going on as opposed to the public getting 1%, that there's a lot going on. And the most important thing is that, you know, two very fast arrests were made in the both cases that happened recently. And that's not common. So congratulations to all involved and where they're, you know, still live situations. I'll just stop my comments there. But it certainly is very impressive for me to watch. There's a couple of future agenda items I want to call the board's attention to and some to the community. For the board, your next meeting, the bylaw committee will come in and discuss somewhere between 7 and 10 bylaw revisions they're going to suggest for November town meeting. I'm familiar with five of them. They have some others they're working on. And the board is going to want to form formally a cable advisory committee. I discussed with town council today, and it's a requirement to do so 30 months in advance, which would be the end of May. So you still have three more meetings to do that. So I figured we'll discuss it at your next meeting and then set up ground rules of what kind of applicants you'd like, and then we'll... And as long as you've started the process, that's 30 months.
The cable TV, you mean?
Yes.
Bob, is that something that goes to the VASC or the entire board?
Probably the VASC, but you could handle it either way. This is
okay.
A little bit of a different kind of committee. It's
right.
A 2.5-year committee. It's not a 1-year ad hoc. So it'll be up to the board as to how to set that up.
Okay.
And I'll bring you examples of how it was done almost 10 years ago, not quite 10 years
right.
ago. It is a fairly labor-intense effort, depending on how that... We have two cable companies now, as Paula's shaking her head over there. She remembers. We have good town council now. In the past, we actually used someone who's currently Stoneham's counselor, was the last time I looked. So there's a lot of legal expertise needed in this. And I would expect the negotiations to be time-consuming and challenging, shall we say.
So is this
yes.
to renegotiate the deals with Comcast and Verizon?
Correct.
Okay.
They're both up in 2.5 years. So if you did not renew them, they both disappear.
And so that's not to do with RCTV per se.
It does indirectly because
their budget is.
Yeah, their budget is.
But
so
I mean, this is just kind of.
But it's an opportunity to bring that into the discussion, certainly.
Mm-hmm.
RCTV gets funded as well as any local company that I'm aware of. They get over $400,000 a year.
Mm.
And partly that's because one of these cable companies wanted to come into town at the time. So, you know, we'll have a challenging negotiation, certainly. So I just wanted to point
that
out.
Well, I'm glad there's
two
of them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
and there are others. Make no mistake about it.
Well, I'm
Wakefield
sure there'll be
one.
Others that'll be interested.
Yes. And lastly, and this is for the community and for the selectmen, Dan and John and I have been meeting with North Reading leadership for the last year or so to discuss the MWRA situation. They have a schedule. A couple of us have gone to one of their town meetings. The North Reading selectmen will be in here on your May 3rd meeting at around 8:00 formally. To make a presentation to the whole community about what the situation is. And then you will reciprocate, for those of you that can, 6:00 on May 11th, a Wednesday, in the North Reading High School. There's going to be a 1-hour selectmen's meeting in advance of a public meeting at 7:00 that night. I expect both discussions to be similar, although the North Reading audience is a lot more familiar with the situation, so it might be a little different. The bottom line to the Reading community is there is potentially some land in Reading that we're, you know, going to have to discuss with North Reading as to their need for it. There is a lot of improvements that need to be made in Reading that we've been planning out for the last year. We have decided that North Reading will handle all the work themselves. They will pay for it all themselves. That way there's no middlemen.
Mm-hmm.
But as a I guess middleman of water, I'll say, there will be wear and tear in our system. There will be some financial billing responsibilities. So we will, if you will, mark up the water as it goes through Reading to get to them.
So I thought they were going to handle their own billing.
We still don't know what the MWRA's intentions are, if they're going to bill us the total of both communities and then let us figure it out.
I mean, the retail end of it.
Right.
Billing
so
the end customers.
We think for the first 3 years that North Reading will bill its own customers. But we will still have to somehow account for water.
Yep.
And it gets complicated. But just so you're aware, that's an important discussion that'll happen again May 3rd and May 11th. And I would invite the community to tune in because although there's a low impact on Reading compared to what it could have been if we had to borrow money and then get repaid, it still is an important project for our neighborhood. So that's all.
Okay. Any questions for Bob? Yeah, I'm sure Jimmy Cormier is laughing up his sleeve. You've been pretty busy. You guys have been a pretty busy month, haven't you? And congratulations
of
for
fire.
You know,
thank
the
you,
great
Chief.
Work.
Yeah.
Just a great job being done. I think that next on the agenda is a proclamation that we have. Is that correct, Bob? That where
mm-hmm.
we at here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I'm going to ask our secretary, Barry, if you would read
yep.
this National Telecommunicators Week. Proclamation.
This is a proclamation for Public Safety Telecommunications Week. Whereas there are 11 public safety dispatchers working for the town of Reading, and whereas our public safety dispatchers serve the citizens of Reading with dedication, loyalty, pride, and whereas the citizens of Reading rely on public safety dispatchers as their vital link to our police, fire, ambulance services, and whereas our public safety dispatchers connect our citizens to our public safety providers who may apprehend a criminal, who may save their possessions from fire, or may save their life or the life of a loved one, and whereas each year the second week of April is dedicated to the people who serve as public safety telecommunicators, and whereas in 1991 the United States Congress proclaimed Public Safety Telecommunications Week as a nationally recognized week, and whereas the week of April 10th through April 16th, 2016 has been proclaimed National Public Safety Telecommunications Week in recognition of the contributions of public safety dispatchers and other telecommunications communicators nationwide, now therefore we, as the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading, Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim the week of April 10th to the 16th, 2016 as Public Safety Telecommunications Week in Reading, and we urge all citizens to recognize the considerable contributions of our public safety dispatchers.
Now, I think because you have a very inexperienced chairman, we did this slightly out of order. I think we were supposed to have...
That doesn't matter.
No, that's okay.
I think we're supposed to have a motion and a vote to... Oh. Make that real,
and while
then we'd
I'm
like
at
to make
it,
a presentation.
You can do it after.
And while I'm at it, move that the Board of Selectmen declare April 10th through the 16th as Public Safety Telecommunications Week in Reading.
Second.
All those in favor?
I can read it again.
I'd like to make
please do.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, Board, thank you a lot for allowing us a few minutes tonight to come and recognize the outstanding work of our public safety dispatchers.
Yep.
This is Dispatch Supervisor Avery. She'd like to say a few words as well.
Please. I do really appreciate the position that I have and the staff that I have, working with some very unique and talented individuals over the years. Just every day it just surprises me at how great they are, and truly I'm thankful for the Chief and current Chief Burns, they're absolutely always behind me and my staff.
I just will say that you do such a good job with you and your people that, you know, it's kind of like a good umpire in a baseball game. You never really notice them, but you always get a good result, and that is what we get here. So
I can imagine there's some sleeplessness that has gone on in the past week as well.
Yeah, a little bit.
Great job on that as well.
Thank you. And
thank you very much.
It's truly my staff that does it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'd just like to say on behalf of the fire department, thank you for all that you do and all the dispatchers do for us. It's a very difficult job. It's the epitome of multitasking when you see them over there in operation. And just like to say thank you for a great job.
Thank you.
Great. Congratulations. So if you would please share this with your team.
Absolutely. They're the ones who aren't doing
it.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you
all
so
right.
Much.
Turn around.
Yeah. Oh,
let me come around.
No, that's good.
Okay.
Good.
All right.
Yeah. Thank you. Maybe we want to get one.
Especially.
Why don't you get one with the two chiefs?
Yeah, that's
thanks
a great
for your hard work.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
Whoa.
Thank you. Thanks, Rick.
Thank you so much.
7:25.
Thank you. Okay. I think that. Could we talk a little bit about this letter of support, Bob? Could you brief us, please? I don't think that there's a pack. I don't think we have anything specifically in the packet. I didn't notice it.
I think there was over the weekend, but let me...
There was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I'll read it aloud. We're asking you to send this to our two representatives in State Senate.
Oh, right.
Your funding request.
And you know, we're asking the board to allow John Halsey as the chairman to send this. So, for instance, dear Representative Jones, the Reading, yes, that's a perfect heraldic sound. The Reading Board of Selectmen asks you to publicly endorse an increase of $1.3 million in line item 9110-9002 local aid to Council on Aging's for the FY17 in House Bill House Budget Number 2. By including this increase in House 2, you would send a clear message of support for our incremental goal to reach $10 per elder per year during FY17. In Reading, the older adult population is expected to increase by 75% in the next decade or so, easily the fastest growing segment in our community. This modest increase of funding is less than $5,000 for Reading, but we believe the message you send is an important one. And I think that it is exactly the message that's being sent here. If you do the per pupil calculation and the per elder calculation, it's rather lopsided.
Yeah.
And I just think as a message that this is a worthwhile thing for you to do.
Okay. Discussion?
You have a motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve a letter of support for the Council of Aging and ask the chair to sign on their behalf.
Oh. Second.
Now, any discussion?
I'm all in favor.
Okay. Kevin?
I'm all in favor.
You know, as we have said in this room before, it's a good idea to let Beacon Hill do Beacon Hill's work. However, right, every time it directly impacts Reading itself, and this obviously does, and it helps to correct the bit of an imbalance we have in, you know, in public funding towards senior issues. So, any other discussion?
I just have a question. How much do we get out of this a year in our budget? Is it part of the general local aid?
No.
Is it broken out, or is it a separate thing? How much do we get?
I think it's on the order of $20,000, approximately. It's a separate line.
Compared to the, you know, what we get for everything else, it's...
Yeah.
It's very small.
It's very small, yeah.
And so any kind of addition is certainly important. I mean, there are other ways that some of our seniors are served, you know, through Mystic Valley, for example, and so forth, but it kind of finds its way through a filtering agent instead of us being able to directly serve our seniors. And, you know, we spend money out of our budget that many towns don't spend.
That's right.
You know, to try to run a good senior program, you know, at our center. So, any other question or discussion before we vote? All in favor of the motion? Opposed?
Point of order, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah. Do we need to approve the other certificate, or is that, because that's going to be presented in a week? Is there a secrecy element here?
No, there's not a secrecy element to it at all. I kind of see. I told you this is a rookie job. And, you know,
okay.
I got to get the old hand to straighten me out over there.
I'll try to restrain
you as my mentor, Dan. We do have another. Certificate that is tied to. The Reading, it's the Reading Rockets, in recognition of Coach Bryan and the Reading Rockets for organizing and volunteering their time to help shovel out Reading seniors throughout the winter. And we've got several of these to be presented, and I think that we were asked to present them at their awards function.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the certificate of recognition for the Reading Rockets for volunteering their time to shovel for the elders.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Great work.
Okay.
Yep.
So we'll be making this presentation, mm-hmm, I believe, at their awards banquet. Is that right?
Yep. On the 14th.
I think it's
at the volunteers' dinner.
Volunteers' dinner.
Okay. So we got to get these things signed up before we leave today.
Oh, just one other thing on what we just voted on.
Yep.
The motion, I think, was general, but in the packet, the letter was going to both our reps and Senator Lewis. So
yeah.
Yes,
that's correct.
Okay. Good. And we'll have them to you to sign Thursday.
Okay, that sounds good. I believe we're now at the time, slightly past the hour of 7:30, for the recreation fees hearing. This is a joint meeting with the Board of Selectmen and the Recreation Committee. Is there a quorum present?
There is.
Kate, would you like to call your board to order? Or your committee?
Sure.
Call your committee to order, just like that. Okay, good. Recreation Committee's in business up here.
Kind of like Tom Brady.
Before we get started, I just as a point maybe of personal preference and probably the right thing for me to do, is that I will I'll be surrendering the gavel and handing that over to Kevin Sexton as the vice chairman. I am a regular user of the fields and have been for many years with the Reading Bulldogs, and I just feel like it's important for me not to be part of this discussion. Yes, Frank?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, being part of the Recreation Committee, Frank Driscoll, I hear that you want to not be involved in the discussion of the fees, but I'm kind of curious on why you were involved in the procedure of deciding which field will be lit and not lit.
Actually, that, in my opinion, was a grander sense, because we were looking at the entirety of Birch Meadow, and it was tied to a capital project that the selectmen had heard many public hearings about, several of which I excused myself from in the early days. When it came down to the end, I did include myself in that discussion, because...
But you benefited very well by the changing in the Recreation Committee selection of which fields would be lit at which time.
Well, interestingly, you may well think that, but one of the things that I did point out during that discussion was that presently, the Reading Bulldogs, which I own and operate, play one game per year in Reading. That was true last year, that is true again this year, and probably will be true going forward, and that is scheduled around a Sunday afternoon day game. So the discussion of, you know, any conflict that might present itself with me really has nothing to do with that. The fees, on the other hand, are something that I pay. And
yeah,
so therefore I feel like it's appropriate for me to step out.
But the thing is that the Recreation Committee sat down and had numerous meetings with a ton of individuals, and we brought our recommendations to the board.
Well,
I just wanted to make the point.
I'll let you finish your comment, and then I'll call on him.
You letting me in? You want me to?
Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, the whole board, as I recall, I polled the whole board since I was chairing that meeting, and we did a consensus around the table. So that was five votes on the priorities, and they were pretty well agreed to unanimously, I believe.
If you would like to review the minutes, what I'd be happy to have you do, Frank,
sir.
And I think this is probably something you might have considered before you raised the concern, is you might have looked at the minutes. And in the minutes, there was no discussion from me about whether to light a baseball field or not light a baseball field. There was one question raised about a safety issue. It's the only comment I made in the entire meeting. And that was raised, you know, by the Recreation Committee. I asked for clarification. Other than that, and you could certainly review the minutes of that public meeting, or you could review the tape.
I have.
Good. And you'll probably remember then that I had no other comment other than a question about safety that was raised first by the Recreation Committee.
My feeling is that you want to exclude yourself from the vote tonight on fees, which again is only going to affect you once by what you just stated to me.
That is correct. I simply added my vote. My only question in that meeting, if you actually watched it, or if you read the minutes, which are available to you publicly,
I have them.
You'll find that my only comments were really tied twice, two questions directly to the Recreation Committee on safety issues that they had raised. And that was the sum total of what I had to say. So, that being said, I mean...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Is there another point that you're trying to make?
None whatsoever, just what I stated.
Okay, good. Well, all that being said, I am going to dismiss myself from this meeting so that conversation can go on, the hearing can go on, and the concern of conflict will be eradicated by my exit. So I turn that gavel over to Kevin, and Bob, I'll call on you to come and fetch me when it's time.
So to the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on Just for you. Thank you.
Good old paper.
The old-fashioned, you know, the old standby. On April 5th, 2016, in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, amending recreation fees, a copy of the proposed document regarding the topic available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. Monday, Wednesday, Thursday from 7:30 a.m., 5:30 p.m., Tuesday, 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the town's website. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to the 6 p.m. meeting on April 5th to the town manager, City of Reading, Massachusetts, by order of Robert LaLasher, town manager.
Thank you, sir.
John, it's all yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, John Fudo, Community Services Director for the town of Reading. Here flanked by most of my recreation committee tonight, Ms. Kate Kammerer, Mr. Frank Driscoll, Ms. Jean Borowski, who just walked in, Mr. Michael DiPietro, Mr. Rich Hand, Mr. Dan Foley, and our Recreation Administrator, Jenna Fiorente. I didn't miss anybody, right? So thanks for indulging us tonight. The Recreation Committee has asked me to present their findings and recommendation for field fees for 2016. I think I should maybe give a little background and set up. When we're considering field fees, we don't do it lighthearted. It's something we understand is very important to our residents and our youth. We want fees to remain somewhat reasonable and affordable for families. But at the same time, we have costs on the other end of that. I did some research to find out what our youth organizations were paying. Pop Warner's paying $200 per season. Reading Little League's paying $225 in their upper part of their program this spring. Reading Lacrosse is $190. Reading United Soccer is $110 to $125. And Reading Babe Ruth is about $160. So the costs are growing every year. It's getting more and more expensive to play sports. We understand that. So raising fees and having it commensurate to what they're getting for value is important to the Recreation Committee. So with that said, I talk about the goal, and our goal is always to cover the costs while keeping our fees reasonable. And I won't do death by PowerPoint tonight. I have six slides planned for you, so we won't be going through a million
Thank
slides.
You. No, there you go.
I sense that you'll appreciate it.
This is the only bullet on this one.
It is. I kept it very, very brief. Right. But this is the single goal of the committee is to keep that reasonable. But at the same time, we have to keep our costs in mind as we bear that
sure.
in mind. To give a little background, fees were last changed in 2006. Many of you probably won't remember, but we made a drastic change back then. We changed the complete module of how we were collecting fees and the mechanism that we were doing that. At the time, we were collecting $10 per game versus $10 per head is what we changed to. So an organization that was playing 60 games was paying $600. If they had 400 kids in the organization, that changed to $4,000. So there was quite a drastic jump at the time. Quite a shock to the system, and it wasn't met with a lot of love at the time, but it was necessary because our costs were definitely underwater at that point. At the same time, DPW was charging us around $13,000 per year for support. That was basically seasonal workers that would come in around April and would work with us till about October, November. They were bringing on 2 to 3 high school, college kids over that time to take some of the edge off, drag in fields, take away trash, pick up trash off the ground, maybe do some auxiliary trimming around the ball fields. We also estimate the cost of administration to run the field schedule for all the youth organizations and adult organizations that use the fields, and that's estimated at about $25,000 for the recreation staff to appropriately delve out fields, listen to any conflicts that we might have, develop some of these projects that you hear us, and we're bringing constant projects to the board that's all tied into to what they get for their field fees. And the third one, and this is one that goes unnoticed a lot, but the revolving fund currently pays for all the electricity used for tennis courts, for the skating areas over the wintertime, any minor repairs. So if you're down playing basketball and you notice a rim's broken, it doesn't magically get fixed, it's paid for out of these same fees. So a lot of things go unnoticed, and that's intentional. We just kind of do things as we see fit. The proposal that we're bringing before you tonight is actually taking us to an estimated $60,000. The past 3 years, the field fees have actually lent itself to bringing in an average of $50,000 per year. So we're looking at about a $10,000 increase in revenue if numbers stay the same across the board. It was all based on our 2015 field numbers. So for those of you that like to see things on a pretty map, the cost analysis, DPW support is 20 grand, administration is estimated around 25 grand, and our minor repairs in costs are estimated at about 15 grand, totaling about 60, so that matches up. And the committee really looked at that as we're trying to cover our costs. Mm-hmm. We're not trying to support the complete DPW for cutting grass and mowing, but there is an auxiliary cost for grooming infields every day and picking up trash every Friday and making sure that the ball fields and the athletic fields are clean and ready to go. So I'll take you to some notable changes that will be on the next slide. And it has to do with probably the most drastic change, and if you want to call it drastic, is the in-town fees were increased. We look at the field fees in three different sets. We look at it as organizations. So those are organizations that are recognized as Reading groups. We look at a second group as regular users. They're not Reading groups, but they use the fields more than once. And then we have a third subgroup is the people that just want to have a birthday party once. So we distinguish those three groups, and we also distinguish between in-town and non-resident in all those categories. So if an in-town group has a non-resident, they're actually charged at a rate of, I believe it's $100 and $120 if they're in-town or out-of-town currently. So it's 10 times the amount.
Yes. Are the men's softball, these softball fields included in the grass playing fields?
Yes.
It comes under there.
Yep, anything on grass is considered grass. Anything on the three synthetics is considered under the three synthetic fields. So those fees went from $10 and $12, that's respectively grass and turf, to $12 and $14, so it's a $2 increase across the board for our in-town organizations. The per-use cost increased for non-Reading organizations, so those are people that come in and play six or eight games, but they're not recognized as a Reading group. It mm-hmm. might be the North Shore Soccer Stars, whoever that might be. And that fee increased on grass from $20 to $30 per hour and $75 to $100 on our Collins field. The school department actually sets the fees for the stadium and turf, turf too for out-of-town residents. However, we did try to look at that and try to keep things pretty comparable. We also considered what surrounding towns were doing. It didn't drive it, but it was helpful to know, and I'm glad to share some of that with you if you care to hear. But I'll just read off a couple that I was able to find through some research. North Reading actually charges $45 per player per season. That's the high end. The low end would be Plymouth. They charge $5. Some towns don't charge anything. They believe that, you know, the organizations support the fields in other ways, so they don't want to take any cost for it. Lexington is $13 per player per season. So I feel like we're kind of right in the middle there, and I think we're in a pretty good place when you compare us to neighboring communities that are like in size and like in comparison. So I just thought that was an interesting point to bring up. The third notable change, and this isn't used very often, but we got rid of the field fee matrix. We used to have this crazy system where we had to go out and count heads if someone was going to run a camp in town. Mm-hmm. We'd have to drive down and count how many people they had on the field. Ease of administration didn't make sense, so the recreation committee decided to go to a flat rate of basically $300 and $500 per day, depending on the field that they're playing on. That was just, instead of having me and Jenna go out and do a head count, it just seemed more more predictable and a little bit easier for us to manage.
John, in relation to that, is that something that you're erring on the side of making sure that, you know, it's similar to what you were doing before? In other words, you know, that these organizations aren't going to just all of a sudden lump double?
Yeah,
on the field, and you know, you lose out as a result of
this. There's pretty good. We had to consider a couple things, Kevin. In that case, we had to protect our own programming model. Our programming model requests 20% mm-hmm. when we do contract work with organizations. Okay. So if we have to give them incentive to stick with us. So we want to actually make it cheaper for them to work with us than to work against us, because the revenue is better, obviously, on the percentage side than on the flat rate side.
Sure.
So we did build that in. When we looked at the matrix was about 15 to 18%. So it was actually below what we were charging. So it was actually working against us. So the matrix didn't make sense.
Okay.
We don't get a lot of those, by the way. We probably get one a year. At this point, most people choose to work with us, which is a good thing. It makes our program more robust.
Okay. Barry?
John, in the earlier slide, basically, it looks like you were going to probably for like 50,000 to about 60,000.
Right.
But the per player cost looks like it went up like 10%, you know, let's say from 12 to 14, more or less. but yet that's only netting an additional 10,000. Is that because the per player piece is a small piece of what, you know, the compared to the other fees?
No, it actually, the per player makes up the majority of the $50,000 to $60,000 that the town will collect in revenue.
But wouldn't that sort of inform sort of a higher, you know, because it's going up 10%, but
it won't reflect because of the, when I based my estimate, I actually took the actual numbers from this year, what each organization had for players, and I applied the new rate to it. So that was a more, I thought it was a better estimate than we went up 10% or 20%, whatever it was, and I didn't apply it to last year's number. I didn't take 48, we made about $49,000 last year. I didn't say, all right, 10% more is 5,500. I actually looked at the real cost because it fluctuates by organization. Some people are paying 12, and less people are paying 10 because we have a lot more activity on synthetic than we do on grass.
And the other thing is that when you went over your sort of cost analysis, when obviously you're covering sort of the day-to-day expenses, you know, the DPW to come and do their stuff and you guys to administer the program and some minor, you know, repairs as the year goes on. But what's not in there, and I think maybe should be in there, is just sort of, you know, like if you owned a rental building, you'd have some kind of a replacement reserve. I mean, because even though it's creating wear and tear on those fields that eventually work its way into a capital plan. And so even if you marginally put in some type of, you know, just acknowledging the fact that you want to acknowledge that it is a cost, because eventually these fields are going to have to be replaced. And I know, you know, we're a baseball family, so the condition of the baseball fields, and I know when we were involved in Reading Youth Baseball, the Little League paid a lot of money to keep those fields.
That's why their fees are so high.
But again, you know, you look at Washington, you look at Simon, those baseball fields could use a lot of work. I mean, obviously the high school baseball field is pristine relative to the others, but it doesn't seem like there's a lot of money going back in there, but yet there's wear and tear. And so I would think that, you know, increasing the fees to at least incorporate that as acknowledging that it's a cost, and then have the fees, you know, go in there so that we can do those kind of replacements.
Bob, you seem to want to comment?
Unfortunately, that's illegal. You can't set a fee based on any kind of current or future capital cost.
Really?
That's just state law.
Okay. Well, you can
do maintenance, but you can't in any sense bank money for a future capital replacement.
Well, I'm sure the money that would be used would be for greater maintenance, but at least it's, you know, it acknowledges that these things, you know, they have a life cycle.
I know that, but that's why the general fund must pay for capital. So the lights, any new turf field, you know, there may well be organizations willing to donate money, and we can accept a donation, but we can't set a fee and send that towards, you know, a replacement of turf or other wear and tear. It just, you know, I don't understand why. That's just
that's interesting.
It's
why?
Yeah, yeah, because it's basically what you're doing is you're not acknowledging that cost exists.
You're exactly right.
Right.
And just for somewhat of a point of clarification, the recreation revolving fund is different than the other town ones and the school ones. To be real general, the school revolving funds can retain, I won't say any amount of money, but a significant amount of money. The town revolving funds, other than recreation, are all voted on by town meeting as to what they have for annual carry forward monies. And then recreation is unique. Is it $10,000 you're allowed to carry?
Yep, it's a $10,000
so
carry.
So any balance over $10,000 on June 30th goes to free cash. They are only allowed to keep $10,000, and that's just for cash flow management over the summer.
I mean, so.
And they are not allowed, unlike the other revolving funds, especially on the schools, they're not allowed to pay wages directly. The general fund has to do that.
Right.
But you are allowed to turn back a surplus that could pay for wages and benefits that are associated.
Ergo, your capital improvements.
So, you know, indirectly, the free cash that's turned back is an offset for some of those indirect costs, but it can't be capital.
Well, can we change? Is it possible just to change the language of the revolving fund to
the state law will not let you recover capital. Period. That's because we had the same discussion with the school department on some things. I was surprised because it's not sensible.
Yeah.
Once again,
however, the general budgeting process can be informed as to how they split capital. Indirectly, it's probably achievable.
The revolving fund, just for your edification, turned back $124,000 last year to the general fund.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Which is great, but there should be some kind of, you know, a sticky put somewhere. That's the next time we need to go and replace, you know, the turf at Simon's, let's say, or what, that, hey, you know, we've been collecting fees, people use it, so that, you know, there's some type of acknowledgement, although it's not going specifically as an earmarked line item, but like, you know.
You could, by vote at town meeting, put money in the stabilization fund, but again, you can't even in the motion say, you know, this is from fees and it's going towards capital. You just have to say, this is from surplus that, by the way, paid for wages and benefits, and we're going to put it there for capital. You might get away with that. But town meeting is pretty well informed of the capital plan and capital costs, by and large. I completely agree with your sentiment, but
yeah,
you just can't.
Me too.
Right.
Continue.
I just take you to the final slide. I was actually done with the presentation, but this is the final slide. I think you have it in front of you. If the proposed fees are on the bottom as recommended by the Recreation Committee. The ones on the top are actually the current. The organizations have been made aware of the changes, and I did not get any pushback or any kind of heartache or hardship from the organization. So I think they understand that after 9 years, it was probably time for us to make a move on it. It was probably a little overdue, but again, we felt.
We'll see what happens when we change the fees for parking.
I'll make sure I'm not here that night.
Yeah.
Barry, go ahead.
When the lights go in, and then obviously there's going to be some pass on costs. Under this as market rates. I mean, so what is it? Just you were here for 3 hours. It's $1 a kilowatt hour times however many.
Yeah, exactly. What we're
is
working
be
on.
Metered each use.
Yes.
Or? We will have ability to do that, which is great. Currently, we're just kind of guessing at it. We're getting a bill and we're guessing who used how much time. The new lights. There's a committee actually working on setting some usage policy and some fees for that they'll come back and recommend. Those fees are actually being aided by the RMLD. We've given them the specifications on the lights and asked them to run us, you know, mock bills on what we think we're going to be paying. So we don't have all that information yet. We've got some of it back, but we are working on it. We'll be back to present that, hopefully before the lights go in.
So there'll be someone tracking the time on field, time off field
Each group. There's a sophisticated program that when you turn the lights on, you can attribute it. You can do cost centers, and you can attribute it to
punching your code or something.
Organization. We're talking about how we're going to administrate. Whether we're considering right now giving the organizations the ability to just turn off lights, not turn them on. Mm. So if they finish early, they can save themselves. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
A little bit of money, so
well,
you say you're on
until pitches to work faster.
Right. On a night where you have them scheduled till 9 and you finish at 8:30, there's no need to have them on till 9.
Major League Baseball should adopt that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
Well, the ticket prices
for the light prices.
does the board have any further questions?
No.
Any public comment? See, there's none.
Ms. Minda.
Oh, sorry.
Couple of questions.
Just announce your name.
Angela,
thank you.
Town meeting member. I just have a couple questions because I know that I watched the 12:15 meeting, the Board of Selectmen meeting where you made a presentation, and I was looking over some things from town meeting. And I know that the point is to cover costs, but there's also been discussion about revenue generation. Is that something that, and I know that, you know, you want to keep costs down for town groups, but there was a discussion in the December about revenue generation, whether it's for out-of-town groups or something. Is that something that you know, is never looked at or you want to stay away from for in-town, for out-of-town? Because also, you know, in the town meeting warrant from last year, you have some areas for increased fee participation, and you have the current at $55,000 increased field fees. If you raised it 20%, it would be 66. If you raised it 30%, if you raised it 40%. So what was the point of that? I mean, are you only ever trying to just cover costs? Are there other costs that could be covered? Like Selectman Vernon said, you know, maybe not.
Yep.
I know you can't build capital in, but, you know, other higher possibilities for fees. So how is that looked at?
I'll let Bob start and I can.
Bob?
Yeah, Angela, at town meeting, what I remember saying kind of brings a couple of these points home. We can't pay for capital, so we can't pay for debt service with these fees. However, instead of having the general fund subsidize some of these other costs, we can stop that,
right,
which has the indirect effect of, if you will, shifting general fund money to debt service. So to the extent that John raises additional revenue through field increases or any increase, that means the general fund has a more of a surplus at the end of the year. That means there's more money available to pay for these capital costs, you know, that Barry has mentioned. So it's somewhat of a nuance. It's a silly one because of state law, but you can't say A is going to B, but you can say A is going to free cash and then free cash is going to take care of B. So that was the discussion I remember just making sure everyone understood.
Yeah. And is there a philosophical distinction between, you know, maybe fees for Reading residents and fees for outside that we wouldn't want to, you know, if you're a Reading organization, you would only want to cover costs? But there was a discussion at the December Board of Selectmen meeting about, you know, increased use in generating revenue. So I don't know where that was going, if that's something that, you know, philosophically you really don't want to do, or but that, you know, the Selectmen were discussing that, so I'm wondering.
Mm-hmm. John?
Yeah, I think philosophically, and the Recreation Committee is welcome to jump in here, I think philosophically the committee feels that the fields are for Reading first, and anything that we can get in on top of that is fine, and it's nice to get the extra revenue into the revolving fund, but we would never give an out-of-town group precedence over an in-town group. I think it feed ourselves first, and if there's space left over and it's manageable, then we manage it that way. But I don't think there's not hundreds of thousands of dollars available in out-of-town use. I think where the opportunity for us is if the organizations continue to grow, and if we've added these lights, if we can grow programs, then it regenerates itself by not just increasing the percentage of what we're charging for fees, but it's all generated based on participation, and that's where your biggest gain can be.
And just one last question. Is there any correlation between what you charge organizations and what the organizations charge?
That's up to them.
Their users, because I know you haven't raised your costs
right.
in 9 years, but you know other organizations
right.
have done.
We don't own
you them. Don't have any.
Yeah, it's impossible to know. I would assume if we raise the fees by two bucks this year across the board, I would think a good business model for the organization would be raise their fee $2. They're certainly doing more than that. I think in 9 years, I'd be willing to bet that those fees have jumped more than 10% or 20%. Just by looking at the raw numbers.
Any other further public comment? Seeing there's none, entertain a motion to close.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing, amending recreation fees.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? 3-0. Opposed?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the recommended field and facility fees as indicated in the memo from John Fueto to Bob Lasher, dated February 29th, 2016.
Second.
Any further discussion? Seeing there's none, all those in favor? 3-0. Opposed? None? Okay.
Thanks, John.
Thank you very much, John. So we'll take a 2-minute break to resume and let Chairman Halsey come back.
I'll text him.
we're back in business here, and I believe we should be looking for our report on the Reading Ice Arena. Is that
correct.
Where we are right now?
That's correct.
Where we are.
Carl?
Good evening. I apologize, I don't have as nice slides like Mr. Feudo has, so I'll just have to grin and bear here.
All right.
I'm your representative for many years now on the Burbank Ice Arena. And every year or so, give an update of what's going on down at the Burbank Ice Arena. This is our original agreement was 20 years, and now we're on, got renewed 2 years ago, another 10 years, so we're starting our third year. One of the, when Mr. Burbank set it up, was that he never wanted the Burbank, the ice arena, to be a white elephant to the town. And so we had put in, well, the town and Mr. Burbank, through negotiation, put in a very strict rainy day fund, I'll call it. And I'm pleased to report that we've exceeded that. We have $310,000 in a rainy day fund. As a lot of you may or may not know from last time I was here, one of the new things that we did, we put in electric Zamboni,
right.
Which certainly improved the air quality down there, as well as, you know, certainly environmentally friendly, which was, that's all paid for. Mm-hmm. We have no debt, shall we say, on there, with $310,000 in there.
Right.
We, one of the big things, kind of piggybacking what the rec was saying, was 2 years ago, thereabouts, North Reading was using it. And the high school teams were using it and some of the youth programs. And there was certainly a feeling that the Reading Youth Hockey, as well as the high school teams, probably could use more time down there. So they were, North Reading was encouraged to find a new place to play, which they did up in Merrimack. So the Reading teams are all of the requirements that the youth programs in the high school needed ice time have been met. So no, there's no need, not being filled, shall I say. North Reading, if there's any extra time left over, like 9 o'clock on a Friday night or something like that, where it's a slower time, North Reading has used it on occasion, but Reading has been taken care of 100%. We're very happy to, we have our audited financials that come out around October, thereabouts. This year, we'll be returning back from what Ed Peduto, the general manager, has told me last week of at least $50,000 back to the town. A cumulative over the 22 plus years, directly, it's been about $2.3 million in direct funds back to the town. In addition, about $300,000 of discounted ice time that goes to the to the school programs. So, you know, when Mr. Burbank had his vision, it certainly has fulfilled that. One of the questions the last time I was here was from Marcy before she went overseas was, and it's a tough conversation to have with Ed Peduto, who's been the general manager for 22, 23 years, is what happens if you get hit by a bus, in a nice way of saying that. You know, what's the succession plan there? And based on the very talented board in place and well-connected in the hockey world, Ed assured me last week when I had to raise the question to him was that the Reading Ice Arena position, if it was ever open, would have pretty much every applicant out there. Because if you look at other rinks, you know, the Wilmington fiasco that's been there, and any Stoneham. So I guess all those places, everyone would love to come to Reading because everything's new, it's well capitalized, the stability, it's the plum job out there. So the succession plan is not really a concern that we have down there. To answer Marcy's question, let me see, anything else? You know, one of the questions Bob had raised to me when I spoke with him last week is the roof. How's the roof? Because, you know, that's obviously a major expense, and it's taken care of, you know, every big. One of the nice things, the chairman, Bill Cummings, of the board, is a contractor, builds very large buildings and stuff like that. So he's always checking to see where the areas are, and it's, as of today, it's in great shape. One of the additional things we do out of the operating account is if there's any capital items, say $5,000 or less, we just pay for it out of cash flow. So we're always maintaining, whether it's painting the locker rooms, making sure all the air filters and everything are up to speed. We don't let anything become a problem. We're very proactive in addressing it. One of the nice things, as Ed will say, is there's a 96-year-old man that happens to show up every week down there to inspect the place. That's the best way to keep on top of things there. So all in all, everything is in great shape down there. There's no white elephant on the horizon for you guys. Well capitalized, well managed. And that's pretty much it. If there's any questions, I'd love to answer them if I can.
Barry.
That's great. It's a great resource for the town. In the contract that just got renegotiated, and with the one that was gone for 20 years, is there a formula? Like you said, the town is gonna turn $50,000 to the town, which is great. Is there a formula, like, you know, percentage of cash flow, or a way that the town, because part of our challenge is to sort of figure out revenues on an ongoing basis. And I remember a couple of years ago when you had to do some major capital work, the town didn't get.
Sure.
Contribution. So is there any kind of way to sort of predict the revenue, or is it a formula? Or?
Yeah, I'll let Bob deal with the legalities of it, but from, and I know you weren't on the board at the time, because when that, I believe you're on FinCom at the time, Mr. Burbank kept his notes from 20-something years ago at the time, and he came in and went through it in terms of the agreement. The way it's in place is kind of like a spirit of the agreement is that we're never going to sacrifice our rainy day fund
right.
in order to give money to the town. And it's kind of like a end of the year bonus, shall we say, mm-hmm. that when the payments to the town. But Bob, I'll let you.
Yeah, I agree. And the mistake, I'll call it, that was made in the past was that we were actually budgeting money. And looking at the legal agreement and being reminded by Mr. Burbank how things worked, we had no business budgeting for it. Cool. It was nice if it happened, but mm-hmm. the bottom line is we should expect zero.
It's not like the RMLD.
Not at all.
No.
Very different.
Okay.
And his point in setting it up, and as Carl has mentioned, is not to cost the town anything, period, end of story.
Not to be
that $2.3 million is frankly a bonus.
And it's very different from the standpoint of liability. We don't have
right.
the same liability, for example, that we would with RMLD.
Right. Absolutely.
So,
yeah, this is really the perfect, I'll call it, public-private
yes.
partnership.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, interestingly, and I mean, if the fact that there has been, I think, 2.2 million, Carl, is what you said.
2.3. Of direct payments.
That's a stunning number when you stop to think about kind of the whole idea of, I get that, you know, it's an authority that's run on a nonprofit basis, however, the fact that that partnership occurs and that cash flow has actually happened is, to me, you know, a stunning example in a good way, as Bob points out. I mean, you also start to think about the savings to the school programs,
right.
you know, and the hundreds of thousands of dollars that would have had to be either expended or passed through, you know, to the participant, you know, student athletes. So, you know, you look at all of it, and it's what a success
yeah.
story.
And you know, one side thing, and not that winning is important, shall we say, but you could argue between the boys and girls is because of that rank, Reading probably has the top public boys and girls hockey program in the state.
It'd be hard to argue anything
yeah.
but that,
so
especially from
yeah.
somebody that lives in Reading.
Yeah, so, you know, the only pressure I think is on the Mr. Daugherty, the boys' hockey coach, is Nelson sits right when he comes off the ice after every
right.
period and is looking at him. So, but Mr. Daugherty's done
sure.
pretty well.
Yep.
So,
any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. And I know you visit us. Don't you normally visit us twice a year, like
twice
usually
quarterly?
After
just once for this.
Okay,
I come back for other stuff.
Okay.
So.
I know you're a familiar face for
yes.
many reasons.
So
thank you, Carl.
Thanks, guys. Have a good
thanks,
night.
Carl.
Thank you.
Thanks, Carl.
Thanks to the whole management team there. Okay, I think next we have the CAB member report. Mr. Mancuso.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good. Thanks for your time again. I'm
happy to report that things are going pretty well over at RMLD. I think by all accounts, it is the budgeting time of the year again. So the CAB will have its first budget presentation tomorrow, followed by a second presentation on the 13th. Based on the recommendations of the CAB, as always, that will then go on to the chairman. They'll take their whack at the budget and then make the final decision about its approval. The one thing that I would mention that might be of interest to you all is that the CAB specifically had asked this year that we flip things around a little bit. There's not really been a policy or an approach to which gets presented first, operating or capital, and we thought it might be good to do operating before capital. And so this year we'll be going through all those operating expenses first and then looking at the capital expense second. So just a little bit of housekeeping. I would say that Ms. O'Brien, the GM, has got a very extensive work plan organized and some very good numbers associated with each of those work plans. So it'll be very interesting to see where that conversation is. And if there's anything specific you would like me to be paying attention to budget-wise, please let me know. The other thing that I would mention is that based on some feedback from outside consultants and the way the general manager is approaching the operation, there's a lot of progress being made to bring RMLD into much more of what I would call a proactive approach to managing the network. And so there's an awful lot of effort, time, energy, and money that's going to be going into really being able to create a network that has greater communications, electronic communications, the ability to understand where equipment is in its life cycle, how that life cycle is being managed. So there's an awful lot of effort going into that. One of the things that will be not directly a result of that, but is a byproduct of that, is I would expect that based on the organization, what I've heard about the organization, we can probably be looking at a pattern of rate increases that will start to emerge. Nothing profound, but RMLD has tended to run operations under the statutory limit of, I'll call it profit, which is at 8%. It's always run sort of 6-5 in the neighborhood. I think the plan is to continue now to run up to that statutory limit. And so given the energy market, given the operations, and given the desire to use that approach to the finances, I would expect that we'll start to see a pattern of annual rate increases, but likely from what I gather in the 2-3% rate. And that's obviously all going back into the network, but something that I think folks should be aware of. The other thing that I would mention, which is of interest, is that there are plans in place to begin to look at distributed generation. And that is literally having the ability to generate some power within the RMLD right. network.
That was also part of Brad's report.
Right? Yeah, and it's I don't want to repeat what you've already heard.
Did you hear what I said earlier? Or?
I'll
go over it.
No.
Yeah,
I don't think he was here.
Yeah, he wasn't here.
So the distributed generation, and one of the privileges we have under the law is that we are allowed to do some of our own generation within our network, where some of Eversource and some of the larger investor-owned utilities aren't. And so there are plans that are being worked on right now to put in a 2-megawatt generator, which would serve basically two functions. One, in its primary function, would be to allow us to reduce peak load so that when we hit those hot days in the summer, what we can, and because peak load is what generates our highest cost of the year, right. we would be able to run that generator, drop peak down, lower our peak, and then have a lower high cost, if
exactly.
you will,
yeah.
which would then allow us to actually see some benefit to the ratepayer overall. Mm-hmm. It also will allow RMLD to receive forward capacity market payments from ISO New England. So ISO pays generators a fee, if you will, an amount of money to know that they have the capacity to generate power when it's needed. And so we'll have the ability to put 2 megawatts into the grid theoretically. Mm-hmm. And so therefore there's a payment that would come from ISO New England. And so that
kind of like net metering works, you know, to the homeowners a little bit.
Yeah, in a way. Yeah, you know, it's but it really is to do with the fact that that ISO needs to guarantee that there's sufficient power to run the grid. and they need to know under all circumstances that they have it. So they will pay people, they will pay power generators money to know that there's idle generation mm-hmm. capacity waiting to be turned on if it was necessary. So although 2 megawatts isn't a huge amount of energy, it still is of some value. And they know that they can pay, they can call on that 2 megawatts if something were to happen, and so they'll pay for that. That's. I'm sorry.
Is there a site location for this generator, or how much space would it? I mean, are we looking at a big thing?
It's not huge. No. It's not really huge. If you think about one of the bigger generators you might see outside of commercial enterprise, and so I'd have to get you the details on what the proposed site locations are. But it's not huge. And RMLD's management team has assured us that they will be talking to neighbors proactively. It's not terribly loud, but it's going to change the background noise, like any generator. You know, it becomes white noise at some point, and it's not that terribly loud. But nonetheless, we've asked, and I think the chairman of the commission has asked that RMLD take a very proactive approach to going out to neighbors and talking to them so that they understand exactly what it is.
We would encourage that as well, because
yeah.
the phone will ring this way.
Yeah.
And it may not be in Reading.
Yeah. Yeah. But in
so that decision hasn't been made yet?
Not that I'm aware of. Not that I'm aware of. So all in all, one thing I would say about distributed generation is it's a sword that can swing both ways. It's a wonderful thing. As RMLD continues to examine the possibilities of distributed generation, there is a capital expense to the community, and there's a fine line between, I think, that capital expense, although that's your expertise, that capital expense and the benefit, knowing that the ISO New England can change the forward capacity market payments as they wish. So that equation is not something we have control over. So. But I do think that if this pilot program goes well, there are some thinking that they might want to look at future opportunities for some more distributed generation. So that's out there. I think that's really the highlights. There is they're continuing to work on a solar project. I haven't heard much more about that in terms of a program which people could buy shares of. If somebody is passionate about solar and they want to buy some power, that project would allow the residents to literally purchase part of that project, which would guarantee them a rate or at least solar source. So that's still coming together. And I haven't heard much more about that, but I know that's of interest.
Yes, Debbie.
I'll jump in. I have a couple of points regarding that. Representative Jones is here. You might have heard talking to our environmental group about
yep.
legislation at the state level. Have you been following much of that yourself?
A little bit,
okay.
Yeah.
He did talk about the solar issue and the net metering discussions that are going on. And apparently, the law. I think the legislature passed a law to drop the amount that is being paid back to the solar person.
Yeah.
So that may affect the incentive to have solar in the future. They're going to lift the cap on the number of installations that are allowed, but they're going to lower the reimbursement that those individuals are getting from the grid.
I think the sensitivity has been, from what I understand, that. A lot of that subsidy was used to create energy and momentum in
yep.
an emerging industry.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think there was some sensitivity to the fact that those who can reap solar benefits and put solar
mm-hmm.
installations on are in some ways being subsidized by all of the
Oh,
other.
They're absolutely being subsidized.
So,
yeah.
So that, I think, is why there's been some back
yeah.
and forth at the state level. And I think mm-hmm. it's a sensitivity. Even here, we have a solar project that I think is going to be going into
mm-hmm.
a commercial enterprise. And so the general manager, to her credit, is very
mm-hmm.
sensitive to, you know, helping that commercial customer and that solar project,
right.
but making sure that it's structured in a way that it has the least possible negative, the most possible environmental benefit
right.
to be able to take advantage of that solar source, but
I
the
think,
least possible.
I think this explains a lot of the flux we're seeing where the company's not sure if they want to jump in and go
it's
to solar projects. It's
yeah, the game's changed, and
it's a very political, politically driven process in a way.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there are other issues that may or may not directly affect RMLD and its sources of power. I mentioned this at the outset, so I'll try to summarize what I said. Brad said that to replace Brayton Point and Pilgrim. which is about 2,000 megawatts. The Baker administration is strongly considering hydropower from Canada and offshore wind. I kind of sat bolt upright when I heard the second part, and I hope you'll convey back to the RMLD that they need to stay on top of this and make sure their voices are being heard if they have concerns about that. First part I'm fine with. It may be a little more pricey, but it's very reliable. We all know what it is. Offshore wind, to me, has never made a whole lot of sense economically. I know Europe is doing a lot of it. I've looked at some of the costs per megawatt hour. They're just not even close to the land-based turbines. And if that's what they're seriously considering, I think our guys need to weigh in with the legislative delegation.
It seems a little surprising that there was nobody. I just passed that along for whatever it's worth.
Well, they might not have been invited. I don't think it was anything deliberate. They just didn't get invited. They should have been.
But I do think that the Climate Committee stays pretty actively connected to RMLD.
Yep.
I mean, I get that they're an advisory committee of ours. However, I know they're highly interactive with the RMLD. And I, when Dan reported that there was no one from RMLD.
No current RMLD employee.
Present. That was a little surprising to me. Not that that was your job to do that. I'm not suggesting.
No,
that,
I apologize. I wasn't aware.
No, no apology necessary. That I think I'm just...
But anyway,
suggesting
yeah.
that.
I was watching it now, Will.
Yeah. But anyway, this is a great and very timely appearance because your job, one of your jobs is to convey our concerns to the RMLD
yep.
as they affect Reading. So
absolutely. So I will do
that.
And I would encourage the board, the energy market is going to continue to be in a state of flux because of what you've just described. We are at a distinct disadvantage. I know there's some power that's going to be coming online in Salem soon. You know, that's going to help.
Is it going to be gas fired? Or?
Yeah, and that's going to help, but it's not necessarily going to solve the overall market problem.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, there's some really innovative things that are going on in terms of managing the grid. And so it's just going to be it's going to continue to be a very complex.
I'm just sensing that there's a political aversion to the lowest carbon emitting form of hydrocarbon, which is natural gas, among certain decision makers in the state. So
it's all politically charged.
Yeah.
Everyone would like a silver bullet, and there's no such thing
no,
in the
isn't.
Energy market.
Yep.
So that's the case. Other than that,
Barry?
Sorry.
A couple of questions. I think you guys are, it's similar to when we talk about water. You're sort of a victim of your own success in the sense that, you know, for years you're putting programs in that's basically asking people to conserve, and our usage has gone down, and your sales have gone down, but yet your costs go up and your overhead, you know, stays the same or goes up. Can you just tell us, are there things that RMLD is doing to think about increasing sales, whether that you know, branch out into other forms, fiber, solar, you know, stuff that would kind of make up, increase new customers, you know,
yeah.
things that would, because you talked about earlier, the first thing in your presentation was that, you know, giving us the warning that, you know, we're going to be seeing rate increases. And my guess is part of those rate increases are because your costs are going up and the sales are going down. And also,
yeah,
I'm sure that's a piece of it. So is there any kind of active discussion about sort of, you know, thinking outside the box?
So I'd say two things to that. There is some conversation, and it has been some conversation, about using the fiber that RMLD has to be able to provide ancillary services, whether it would be telephony services or whether it would be more entertainment cable-oriented services. Another
bidder.
I was just going to say, we're going to have a third bidder in here?
The conversation's an interesting one, and the conversation's an interesting one, and it is probably more complex than the energy market itself.
Yeah.
And so there are a lot of, there are opportunities, but you're talking about two of the most highly competitive telecommunications markets, entertainment markets. And we have, this is my opinion to the board, so it doesn't reflect the overall discussion, but I think what I pay attention to, if I'm paying attention to the right things, are do we have the competence, do we have the legal, and do we have the revenue to be able to turn that into a viable opportunity? And I'm scared by all three, because...
Yeah, what's your competitive advantage is the question.
You've got to be a content provider. What do you know about content?
Yeah, well, and yeah. even if Selectmen's even.
Meetings. Yeah, I mean, well, we'll give you that. But
yeah, it's only going to get you so far. If you think about, you know, I'll just use Comcast as an example. I know that they have upgraded the capabilities of their network anywhere from 6 to 8 to 10 times a year because that's what's required in today's IP-based streaming video competitive service market.
Sure.
And so it's not just what does it cost us to get into this market, but then what does it cost to stay in this market? And then the competitive question, when you only have 29,000 potential ratepayers and you have two of the giants in your neighborhood, the cable TV thing, really, that ship sailed 25 years ago. You know, honestly, communities like Shrewsbury were able to put in their own cable service, but that's because they weren't competing against Comcast the giant or, you know, any of the other big. So, my personal opinion is that would be a huge challenge. The telephony piece, I think, is equally a challenge in many ways because the profitability in that market is doing this. And so, again, you have limited, and then there's another, you have limited opportunity, so there's some challenges there. There's the third part, which is actually my biggest concern, and I speak to this based on the fact that I do a little bit of work on this at the federal level, security. So if you can't really provide access to that fiber, if you do provide access to that fiber, you need to ensure that it would be completely secure, because we're a link in the electric grid. And if you've read the news, the threats to the electric grid are very real. And so, to answer your question directly, Barry, yeah, they're doing the due diligence to ask the questions, I don't see that emerging as a, yep, that's going to be generating revenue for us. The other thing that I would tell you, which I'll be very honest about, I had asked the CAB to consider and the commission to consider that there was more of a joint effort between the communities and the RMLD on economic development efforts. And what I specifically spoke to at the time was we have some of the lowest power costs in the state. We selfishly, Reading, because I represent Reading, I don't have to be like the commissioners and represent all the other communities. Selfishly, we have this wonderful intersection of 93 and 95. And so there are many companies, according to Associated Industries of Massachusetts, it's like one of the top five concerns in the state is energy costs. And we're sitting on some of the lowest energy costs in the state. And so the best way we could help RMLD would be to grow the usage of what we have a core competency at, and that is to grow high-end users of commercial-grade power. That's easier said than done.
Cool. Well, that's a big,
And that is a mutually beneficial, process that you're describing. I mean, we have precious little land to develop in a relative way, and frankly the needs to get that developed at its highest possible use, generally speaking, that would be with somebody who would be a high user of one of the lowest cost products in the state, which is electricity. So yeah, there's this certain synergy that we are really all on one page. So one of the questions that comes up for me when you mention the fact that we'll probably have an expectation of some rate increases that will go on, do you feel that they will be kind of in line in a relative way to where we stand today? So if in Massachusetts, if we're not the cheapest, we're among the least expensive electricity providers in the state. I know that to be true. As those rates rise, based on what you're telling me, will they rise in proportion to what's going on everywhere else? Will we maintain our relative position so that it's a selling point for the right kind of campus coming, for economic development?
I think it's going to take the economic discipline to sit down and make sure the budgets don't start being, that we there's a fine line, if you think about how the network has been run and how it's being run today, there's a fine line in a very finite network, which is what we have, between being so proactive that you're investing in all the bells and whistles and being reactive enough, you know, to keep your costs down. And so, for example, I'll give you a sort of a microcosm example. If you have a transformer, and you can spend a lot of money on making sure you understand that transformer's life cycle, how it's operating, what it's doing, and how it's performing, so that you can anticipate when it may need to be serviced or it may fail. The other approach, at the other extreme, is since you only have 29,000 customers in a very few square miles, you can wait until it fails because it's only going to take you a half an hour to get a truck over there. Now, there's other mitigating factors like the environment. Does it spill oil? How do you make sure that there's safety involved in the network for the linemen? But the two extremes are proactive. We make sure nothing ever does anything bad, or we can fix it in 10 minutes. Why would it matter? And so part of the answer to your question is, how do you find that balance?
Yeah.
The other part of the answer to your question is, we're going to be just like the rest of the market. So whatever happens to energy supply, we're going to have to pay some price.
That part I think is fine, but I think a message from us that you could take back is, we see the energy rates, the electricity rates, as being a selling point for economic development in our precious, you know, preciously small amount of property that can be developed. And so it's our urging that continues to stay that way, understanding that boats rise, and you know, and that's okay. But yes, Dan.
Another thing we're doing, and Bob reported on this earlier, this will help leverage, we think, some potential up in North Reading. They have the flip side of what we have. They have lots of land, but they're tied on infrastructure. They're tied on water specifically. So we're going to be looking at plans to run MWRA water up to North Reading, and that might open some opportunities by the time they switch over in 2019 or so.
Yeah, we serve all those
people. Keep an eye on that.
See, do think that the economic development, if we're able to have the economic development that all of us here talk all the time about, the net gain for RMLD is very high, because the likelihood is that you will have a high user, you know, who will, you know, end up coming into such a development. So I think that there's a real partnership opportunity, strategically speaking, as we go forward, to hold that line and not veer off in the direction you talked about, where we spend so much money on the bells and whistles we lose track of the fundamental of the pricing.
Mr. Chairman, I'd encourage you to work very closely with the RMLD. They have the ability to, they're very good at being able to put together the numbers and the presentations and the packages. Mm-hmm. So if there were mutually identified parties that you wanted to discuss with, prospects, you know, they can do a great job of putting together a very robust package that makes it pretty clear that if you use a lot of electricity, this is a real good place to be. Yeah.
That's a good point. Yes, Kevin.
Well, Bob's probably about to make the same point, but this sounds like a good opportunity for a new economic development planner to do just that, to work in coordination with them as part of that job responsibility.
I was going to add that their plans are more than just plans. They landed a very strong customer in Wilmington already.
Oh, good.
And the town manager reports that the cost of electricity was a significant factor in that decision to locate there.
An analogic level user, or not quite that?
Not quite that.
Not quite that. Okay.
Staff at RMLD has attended all of our economic development public meetings, very interested in it, very willing to discuss the property, being very flexible. They just want to have a server farm put somewhere. That's their idea of economic development. But they're working well with us on economic development. Right. So.
Great. Anybody, anything else for David?
Thank you very much.
Comprehensive. Very comprehensive and interesting report, David.
Thanks,
appreciate
David.
It very much.
Take care.
Yep.
Next on our list is a report from the Housing Authority. Please.
this year.
Yeah.
Good. Tell us all about it.
Well, 2016's been very busy, even though we're already winding down. We started off the year with the retirement of one of our long-standing commissioners, Karen Flamia, and then we had the opportunity to add my former Reading Police Liaison, Richard Robbins, to our Board of Commissioners, which has been a great asset because of his familiarity with the Housing Authority over my last 15 years. Then we moved on to two long-term employees leaving the Housing Authority, one to retirement and another to just another opportunity. So that resulted in all sorts of changes as well. And we've had a nice opportunity to add a new employee that is bilingual, which actually helps us in our position. So that's been an improvement. We had approximately $80,000 in capital funding projects this year that we've completed all but one, which is actually going to just be pushed out because of we want to look into it a little bit further. We have approval for $110,000 worth of projects starting come July, which we've already kicked off and are, you know, doing our prep work for those. We added an additional two-bedroom unit to our affordable program, and we're working on a second. And no one else that I know of is leaving our agency, so I have a staff that's been in place for I've been doing it now, let's see, I'm sorry, 19 years, 16 of which have been here in Reading, mm-hmm. and I have just one new staff. Other than that, everybody's been there as long as I have. So it's been a pleasure. That's about it. No new changes. Same regulations. Same efforts to keep all of our properties fully leased up. Our preference for all of our Reading residents is still in place. The only change we did make is due to the staffing changes. We do have a larger agency that is assisting in the management of our federal program. But we still maintain budgets of approximately $3 million a year with between the federal and the state projects. Other than that, there hasn't been anything new.
Questions?
So when we, like for example, the 40B that is going to have, if it gets built, we'll have some form of component of affordable housing. Does that fall under your purview?
They've asked, in the past, we've provided guidance as to, income levels and that sort of thing. And we've also in the past been asked to administer some of those programs. However, I've always had only part-time staff other than myself because of the size of our agency. So it hasn't always been financially feasible for us to monitor those programs, but we have assisted in the lottery process in providing income information, current stats, that sort of thing.
So if we have an affordable unit that comes up for sale or something, I don't know if that falls under you guys. Is there a way to kind of monitor that we're not losing any affordable units? Because a lot of these have deed restrictions that give like the Housing Authority the right of first refusal. And are we finding the people and keeping those units affordable? Because as we're like the gerbil in the cage, we're running and running and we're not catching up. So is there a way or that your agency is helping preserve the ones we already have? I mean, it's hard to get the new ones created, especially half the time they come from above. But is there... Can you just tell us what you do to kind of preserve those affordable units?
I am going to refer that to Tim because I know he's going to.
Tim Kelly, board member chairman this year. That really doesn't fall under our mission. We manage property and state and federal programs. So we, there's a relationship as far as there have been some projects either where there's linkage from the from a town bylaw where we've had some, we may have been assigned a role, but in general the role of keeping Reading's affordable inventory up isn't, that's not our role, and we don't monitor that per se. You know, we've always worked, tried to work well with the town. We're actually a state agency, and but you know, we've always, we, the units that we own, in our program we call them RHA owned units, those count towards the affordable inventory in the town, and those are going to be in perpetuity because we're just going to continue to own them. So in fact, that was one, there was one unit that we purchased with a right of first refusal up at Gazebo Circle this past year, and even though it was in an affordable, so-called affordable home ownership unit, it I don't think it was counted in the state inventory, but now it is, so that one was added into the, sort of the town inventory.
Well, when that happens, Bob, do we get credit for any of the other units?
If there's a human being alive that understands how that works, yeah. I don't know them. next meeting on April 19th, Gene will be in to ask you to renew a intermunicipal agreement with North Reading, Saugus, and Wilmington. And I think this is a good discussion for them because Reading is in charge of the question you asked. They're a resource for us, as are others. Those four towns mentioned, the three plus us, share a position that's regionalized, and her job specifically is to keep track of this. You know, I somewhat joke about the state's bureaucracy, but honestly, if you ask anyone at the state if they understand it, they have to say they don't. It's impossible to understand. There's so many lists and so many rules, and none of it is internally consistent.
Yeah.
That's really extremely frustrating to try
to do. Every time, I mean, as we're looking at a lot of different bylaws over the course of the last couple of years here in town, we're seeing that over and over again.
Well, yeah, we're certainly our own worst enemy when we don't keep things fresh, and we've seen we've caused some issues ourselves.
Right.
But I have to say, we're not in the shape of the state.
Sometimes when we try to fix it, our own, what we find is conflicting state law,
you know,
from different, you know, different departments.
Well, as town council mentioned over at the Pleasant Street Center on ethics and open meeting law,
yeah,
there's two agencies of the state that run it. They each have their own set of rules,
true.
And they contradict each other.
Yeah,
you have to obey them both.
Well, we found a similar thing when we were doing the Firearm Safety Committee.
Yeah.
You know, that you had two sets of rules that really were in conflict with each other. So I do have a couple of questions. So, and I'm not sure whether to direct it to you or to Tim, but so are the inventory that you are owning and managing is plus one from a year ago when you were here to see us, or have we moved any away? Or
no, we haven't lost it. Just we added one, and we're hoping to add another that we're working on.
Okay.
It may happen before the end of our fiscal year, which is June 30th.
And so one of the things that's on my mind is, you know, this 40B that seems to surface, the proposed 40B that seems to surface every time we're in public, you know, on a different, you know, level, whether it's the Historic Commission or it's the Zoning Board of Appeals, it surfaces over and over again. And it's my understanding that if this proceeds, there'll be 20%, which I guess is going to be like 15 affordable units. Is that right?
It would be 20%, but you'd get the full count.
You get the full count when it, in the numerator denominator, you know, situation. But when we actually talk about not credit, but what you really get, which is affordable units to the tune of 15.
Yeah.
And so I think what I'm understanding you to say is that, and I'm not sure about this, but help me. We have said to them in various open meetings that we want a say in the lottery. We want a say about whether or not Reading residents are going to have the opportunity to compete for those affordable units. How can you help us in that regard? Because when we've brought that up to them, they kind of shine us on and say, oh no, we'll have a separate, you know, consulting group that'll come in. I want it to be you guys. So how can you help us?
Well,
with
in
that?
The past, we have worked with, I think there was a couple of other developments that.
We worked with Archstone.
At Archstone, and then there was another smaller one that was up by the Home Goods and whatever.
Yep.
Chapper happened to oversee that lottery process. They are still in existence. In fact, some of the gentlemen at that point that worked for Chapper now work for one of the, I think the current monitoring agent. They're an employee of one of the current monitoring agents. And we did work with them. Because, you know, we talk about the, you know, the medium income levels and the guidelines. And there were lotteries which gave a preference to a Reading resident, a first-time home buyer. They met, you know, income guidelines that it generally is not very low income guidelines. They go to the next level of income guidelines in order for them to even qualify for a mortgage. And at one point, we were involved in processing the applications or assisting in processing the applications. I actually did them, and going through them to meet, you know, to just, you know, do the qualification stage, like we do for any of our participants on our programs. I don't think of like Reading Woods. We weren't in Johnson Woods, or
no.
Johnson Woods. We were not involved in. Other than I did get phone calls from the organization that was handling the lottery. It's expanded a lot in Massachusetts, and we get calls all the time from other housing authorities that are actually trying to add their own inventories and do what we've done. We're one of the few housing authorities in the state of Massachusetts that now own 18 of our own properties above and beyond, you know, a state development. And we get calls all the time from other agencies on how you're doing it and you know, the partnerships and that sort of thing. So these agencies, and now there's a lot of lottery agents out there. There's former directors of housing authorities that are actually who
it's
retired
a whole
from
cottage
housing,
industry, it sounds like.
Yeah.
That are now being monitoring agents for a lot of towns and cities.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them I've known, former director of Needham. You know, she's still doing it, as I understand.
It strikes me that as part of the negotiation, as we move downstream, I feel personally that if you folks were involved, I would feel better about the protection of, you know, those people in Reading. I want them to have, you know, I'd love to have them have preferential treatment, but certainly fair treatment when it comes to the opportunity to get these. And so I guess what I'm asking you, because it concerned me a little bit that you said you might not have the staff to be able to handle this, is that
correct? It's very time consuming.
And so we're sitting here in a public meeting. I mean, we're going to be negotiating with these people.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they're looking to put a very large project in our town and cut an awful lot of our zoning corners in order to be able to do that. You know, is it inappropriate for them to fund a position?
No, it's not.
I mean,
because
is that without precedence
with
is what I'm
fees.
Asking you.
It can be funded with fees.
Okay, you know, this is important information.
That's my opinion.
Yeah.
As a former fee accountant for housing authorities, that's what I did before I took on the position. I said, it can be funded with fees.
Yep. Well, that's really valuable information, and I think that's something we need to consider going forward.
But I think you also, as a town, at the town level, with your planning department and whatever, should be able to, in your negotiations, talk about those preferences.
Well, we have, and we've been pushed aside. And frankly, I know that's not the final answer in that discussion. There's more to that discussion.
Mm-hmm.
However, having said that, I don't want to speak out of school, because if you guys are set up to be able to handle this, that actually makes all the sense in the world. And if it's a funding issue, that becomes a negotiating discussion. I mean, I think it's incumbent on us to do everything we can do to look out for Reading and its citizens in a situation like this.
It most agencies that have been involved in that sort of thing usually have one person that's assigned. Usually they've had a federal background, which we have a federal program,
mm-hmm.
To continue to monitor them and do annual recertifications and do all the reporting that's required,
yep.
And things like that.
Any other questions from anybody? Thank you. This has been
very
informative. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Appreciate
Keep
the
it up.
Information and the input. Thanks for all
Thank
of
you
coming
Thank
to
you
visit
tonight.
Us. Thanks.
So that being this
Okay, I think we need to keep moving right along here. We're running a little behind schedule. I think it's time, Barry, for us to open a hearing on traffic rules.
Yep. To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on April 5th, 2016 in the Selectmen's Room on enacting Article 5.17 of the Traffic and Parking Regulations, 830, police vehicle parking only. Designate police vehicle parking only on Middle Street on the westerly side for a length of 73 feet between Union Street and the police station driveway. Enact Article 5.18 of the Traffic Rules and Parking Regulations, granting the Chief of Police authority to regulate the parking and traffic control in the off-street parking lot immediately surrounding the Reading Police Department station. Copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. During business hours, all interested parties are invited to attend the meeting or submit their comments in writing or email prior to 6 p.m. on April 5th, 2016 to Town Manager, CI Reading, MA. By order, Robert Glasher, Town Manager.
Thanks, Barry. Chief.
Good evening. Thanks for having me again tonight. When I took over 3 months ago, one of the biggest concerns my employees had was the parking at the police station, not just for their personal vehicles, but also for the 18 police vehicles that we use on a daily basis, 24 hours a day. So I spoke with the town manager about it, and I came up with a plan. I worked with the engineering department to come up with a plan, and I met about a month ago now informally with many members of the residents in that area from Union and Middle Street in that area. And we had a nice conversation about 3.5 weeks ago. And after talking and understanding their concerns as well about the parking in the area, I've come up with this final plan that I'd like to propose to you tonight. So if we can go through this. Okay. So back in past and present, in 1999, 2000, when we actually, 16 years ago, we had 13 police cars. Now we have 18. And 4 speed trailers, which you see around town a lot. Police officers, we had 37 then, now we have 42. Civilians, there were 2 back then, now there's 5. Dispatchers, there were 7 full-time in 2000, now there's 11 full-time. So we've grown dramatically over the last 16 years. So parking has, again, increased. Okay. Due to the increase in staffing cruises, we have a parking shortage on a daily basis. The shortages have increased on weekdays between 7 a.m. and 5 p.m. due to the community room being used, obviously, quite a bit during that time period. The parking shortage problem also occurs when they're meeting in the community room, which is open to the public 17 hours a day. And here's just some pictures of the area we took back on March 11th while the community room was in use that day as well. That's Union Street right there. There's Middle Street. And there's the police parking lot, all taken on March 11th. Okay, there's the rear Walgreens. The reason I'm showing you that picture is because sometimes some of our officers' personal vehicles has to be parked back there to find adequate parking for them while they're working their shifts.
Bob, is that a private or public lot in back?
It's both. There's different sections.
Okay. Thanks.
Proposed changes. Okay. 3 spots on Middle Street. Located just outside the rear of the police-only entrance, the closest space is to where officers write reports, necessary to have on-duty crews easily accessible for emergency calls, easy in, easy out for fast response time, possible responding from the station. On this map, you can see what I'm talking about is right on the blue right here, which is, this is Union Street right here, this is Middle, this is the police station. There's room for 3 spots right there in that location for 3 police cars. Our roll call rooms are located right inside that doorway, so when officers need to respond to a call, it would be behooving to be able to get in the cruiser right here and be off to go if they're in the station while an emergency is happening.
Chief, the no parking is already in place, correct? The black lines there. That's not part of the change we're voting on.
That's correct, yeah. That's all, yeah, exactly. Okay, so here's a change within the lot itself. What I'd like to do is 13 spots, 10 here, 3 here, 3 spots there, and then 3 for the chief, the deputy, and the officer in charge of the station parking within the lot itself. Right now, for example, the other day when the media was out there on Friday morning, I drove around the lot 3 times and ended up parking down on Pleasant at Middle Street to go speak to the media that morning because we had the community room in use. That happens a lot. And it's not just me, it's also when officers come in to write reports, they're parking their cars anywhere they can and trying to find a space to park when they're in the station. Quite honestly, it doesn't work if there's an emergency going on. I need to have an area where the officers actually have a designated spot so they can park their police cars in. So when they go out, they know where they are and they can get right out to the call. Or when they come in at night, there's a place to park so they can come in and write the report or deal with an issue that might be happening in the police station. I'd also like to do is, because of the, it's a different world than it was in 2000, after 2001, I'd like to have this part of the lot more secure. I'd like to do is put signs, police entrance only here, police only beyond this point. So any of the extra spots here between employee parking for the community room, absolutely they can use. What I'd like to do is the public those to turn here and just go back out this way and have this area just for secure police cars. As you can think, as you know, our police cars are armed with a lot of equipment and weapons and expensive equipment in every police car. Prisoners are transported to be taken in and out of the prison bay, which is located right here. Sometimes if we have more than one prisoner, we end up pulling a cruiser out front here and taking prisoners right out of the parking lot here and into the back of the police station. And quite honestly, when you have civilians walking through that area, when that's happening, it's not a secure, safe area whatsoever for anybody.
I can move on. All right, and that's my considerations for the lot. I'll absolutely entertain any questions you have, concerns, or at all from yourselves whatsoever.
Go ahead, Greg.
So, Chief, you're saying that there's no designated parking spot for the chief of police?
No, there's not at this time.
I mean, you go to every school, it's reserved for the principal. I would think that...
And many others.
Many others.
Yeah, and many others. Was that ever... I know you've only been on the job for a little bit of time. Is that... Bob, why don't we have a spot like for the chief of police? Has that ever been talked about, or...
Every man for himself. Well, as the chief said, when when the station was built, it is a different world. You also have an empty drugstore over there that I assume someday it's going to be filled. There's not a lot of retail business over there right now. So I think his timing is really good, that there has to be designated police parking of some sort. How much, where, that's for you to decide. You think of the last couple of weeks when, there was a lot of media around and the chief can't go answer the questions and have a press conference because he can't find a place to park.
Or he's walking three blocks, four blocks to get to his own police station to meet the media, who all have found a place to park in your lot.
Yeah, probably. Well, one offer would be a ride from the corner, but I wouldn't want to take that today.
So really,
it's just kind of common sense.
What you're really proposing, I'm glad you put that slide back up. Essentially, you're taking three spots and reserving them on the street. So that's the real change in the neighborhood, right?
Correct. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I mean, and so particularly given where those are and their proximity to, where your officers are coming out, and the fact that we don't to me, it becomes a no-brainer. You have three spots. There is, of course, there'll be some impact to the neighborhood, but it sounds like you've talked with the neighborhood, and I'm sure it's a public hearing. We will probably hear more, but it's really a trade-off of three spots in behalf of a pretty significant public safety issue. The idea that we don't have designated spots at the moment, just kind of for the cruisers themselves. And part of the problem, for sure, is we don't have enough public meeting spaces, and that's such a great spot.
Absolutely.
That everybody uses it. Hopefully, when the library opens up, that's going to change, because I think there's going to be a lot more opportunity for public meeting spaces. I remember the original proposal. It may give you a little relief, although I doubt it. It's a great spot.
Yeah.
How hard is it going to be to enforce that except police beyond that? Is that just signage? You think that'll take care of it?
I think it's signage. I've talked to the engineer in the department, and between signs and also some white line going across, a straight layer on both ends.
Yeah.
And, you know, and signs on both sides when you enter each area, it should take care of it for us, you know. And if someone struggles through it, we understand. It's not an issue. I just don't want to.
Yeah, well, somebody's not going to, I mean,
of course, you know.
One would think that you could certainly make a mistake.
Absolutely, you know, of course. We just don't want it in general, just coming through that way.
Dan, you had a question?
Yeah, that used to be part of a bigger parking lot before the station was built, called the Union Street parking lot. Is that still a Bob treated and regulated as a public parking lot? In other words, 3-hour parking? So anybody who wants can park anywhere they want right now?
Is it 2 hours?
Is it 2 hours?
Actually, I think they mean inside the lot itself?
Yeah.
They can inside that lot as far as I look. I think it's not signed at all. No, they could actually park anywhere they want.
Are there people that tend to park there for long periods, maybe beyond 2 hours?
Besides the employees and maybe some of the people, the public town, but I don't think we really have too many people who come into the lot besides employees and also obviously people using the community room.
Yep.
Although there is some signage in the front about if you're on police business.
There is, yes.
Yeah.
People have to recognize that being in their community room is not police business.
Right. Yes, right.
So if you want to come and get your sticker, there's still those spots will be open.
Absolutely.
For the 5 minutes it takes you to get.
Without question.
Yeah.
That's all. Yeah, Kevin.
Yeah, I just want to make the comment. I had no idea that wasn't designated that. For police use only. I always assumed every time I've gone over there that was the case,
yeah.
Because I think in any other police department, they do have a section designed just for police and police use only, especially as the chief has pointed out, from prisoners getting in and out of their vehicles and into the station house itself, just from the security of that alone. You know, little Mrs. Johnson walking by as this person being, you know, brought into the station house doesn't
right.
seem like a very good idea. So I was surprised to find out that this wasn't already the case. I've always just never parked there and go and parked in the other municipal lot if I needed to use the police station because I thought it was police only. I mean, to me it makes perfect sense. I'm assuming it seemed like we had a couple nodding heads in the audience from abutters in regards to the street parking.
So I'm one of the neighbors. I'm Joyce Gould. I own the property on John Street. And this was a great result from an overall longer conversation that we had that evening that you posted us there. It's a very old neighborhood.
Yep.
And when you look at the residents that share the Union Street, which when you showed that other chart that you had that showed the one side of the street
yep.
parking, there are over 31 residences that share the 20 spots on Union because it's three families, nine
sure.
cars, two families, six cars. I mean, there's a lot of dense pack in that neighborhood. So the fact that it's the three spots at his back door and the change in the parking lot, you know, we fully support. We think that's a great idea. We're concerned about, as the whole town is, about the fact that there's more and more cars and where are people going to put them, and that's exactly the problem in an old neighborhood with multifamily homes.
Sure.
They weren't built to have six and eight and nine cars parking in the lot.
There's
so
a lot of
off-street driveways.
Parking in those houses,
yep.
too.
Well, and it's a very narrow street. Union
mm-hmm.
Street is a very narrow street,
mm-hmm. yep.
so there's no way you could park on both sides either. So I think one of the neighbors came up with an interesting suggestion
mm-hmm.
To say that driveway in front of the front door of the police station, you know, maybe we could turn that into one way and have some angled parking added in there to, you know, give the chief and police business a little bit more parking available there. You know, I don't know who owns that driveway. It obviously goes right behind the dry cleaners and all of that. But that was a great suggestion from one of the homeowners saying,
mm-hmm.
if you need more parking, you know, that looks like some underutilized space. And I can't, you know, but reinforce when all those news trucks were there. Oh, my goodness. It was that whole side of Union Street because it's not just the big trucks with the dishes. It's their support vehicles that come with them. So that's, you know, a madhouse. I'm not surprised you couldn't find a spot, sir.
Other comments from the public? I actually don't think this is the last time we're going to have this discussion. I mean, I think that there's some, sounds like there's some good resolution, and I would compliment you on your work with the neighbors.
No, thank you.
To get to a good result. But the Reading Police Department is not going to get smaller.
Right.
Given what the world is like today.
Right.
So, other questions for the chief? Okay, here we go.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on enacting Article 5.17 of the Traffic and Parking Regulations.
Second.
All in favor?
Move that the Board of Selectmen enact Article 5.17, police vehicle parking only. No person shall park any vehicle in a designated parking vehicle, police vehicle parking only on any parts of the streets listed to which this article has been applied as listed under Article 12.
Second.
Yeah. Discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 4-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve designating police vehicle parking only at the following location. Street to be amended, Middle Street. Location on street, westerly side for a length of 73 feet between Union Street and the police station driveway. Regulation, Article 12, pursuant to Article 5.17.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 4-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen enact Article 5.18, police station parking lot, by granting the Chief of Police the authority to regulate the parking and traffic flow in the off-street parking lot immediately surrounding the Reading Police Department Station House, more specifically located on, I'm not going to read the parcel. Such regulation shall be appropriately signed and subject to periodic review and adjustment by the Town Manager and Board of Selectmen as needed.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? 4-0.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your support.
Thanks, Chief.
Thank you.
Don't call me until at least tomorrow.
Have a good night.
Thank you. I just want to publicly thank the neighborhood, too, for their, they were excellent to work with and their candor coming to the meeting. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck, everybody.
Yeah. Thanks. Okay. The time has come, I believe, for our next public hearing.
Can you just declare it reopened again?
Okay,
I don't
good.
Have to read it.
No.
You already did that.
Yep,
so
already did it.
This is a, we're picking up a continued hearing, and I'm declaring this hearing reopened from our previous meeting to amend the liquor license policy. Bob, do you have some briefing for us, along with, sounds like we have counsel here as well?
I do. We have a letter from Town Council. First, to take a step back, this hearing was opened when the board had only three members over at the Senior Center.
Correct.
You've now got four.
Is it a problem that the same three are not in the quorum?
No.
Okay.
The one member here may, or two of you may need to
I was watching,
up.
But I wasn't participating officially. Yeah.
To really broadly address the issue and remind people, some time ago, 2.5 years, I think, the applicant had come to the board and discussed having a paint and sip operation. Prior town council suggested some language, which is currently in your liquor policy. The applicant then went looking for property and came back within the last few months and asked the question again. Current town council looked at the policy and was not satisfied with the way it was drafted. It didn't really fall into any of the categories that the ABCC has for granting licenses, and suggested that the board had at least two options. If the board wished to enforce a food policy, then that was one path. If the board was open-minded and did not insist on addressing or insisting on food, then a general license classification made more sense. And certainly, in my opinion, I can't philosophically answer the question as to whether you do or don't want liquor or food, but in the operation that's proposed, food is clearly a very minor portion of it at best. And the last policy that a prior board approved suggested that the town manager could judge what food was being served, and I said at the time that's probably not the best use of the town manager's time, since cheese and crackers would be fine with me. That's what I had for dinner tonight. So I don't know, but that was just a formality, I think, by the board at the time to insist that food was always a requirement. They didn't want to open the door to bars. So that's really the issue that's in front of you. Town Council has written a memo to me dated February 23rd that I have. And this is a microcosm to answer this issue in front of you, but there's a larger issue, which is your whole alcohol policy does need to be looked at.
Mm-hmm.
We believe you can solve this issue here tonight. And one of the questions that some board members had asked, there are 10 available liquor licenses for the town right now. Town Council can answer the question as to if one is granted, to this applicant, should they apply, what's the process for the next nine? Because I'm sure you all remember in our economic development plans, there was a number between 6 and 8 restaurants that should, Reading should have the capacity to support that. Presumably they would all want a liquor license. So so town council can address how you can plan some orderly disposition of licenses, if you will. And I think that brings us up to where we are today pretty well.
Yes, Dan.
I just want to give my thanks to the chair for keeping the hearing open for the benefit of Barry and myself, yeah. So we can offer some comments before the vote is taken.
I'm sure I'll ask questions yeah. that were probably already asked, so I apologize okay. in advance for that.
Technicality, though, we're being asked to approve the to revise 324 in accordance with the council's memo, but there's still some placeholders in the memo. I'm referring specifically to items 2 and 3, sections 2319 and 2319 and 32120, 119.
Yeah, I think the final motion, depending on what you decide, the final motion will have to incorporate all the business you do. So that draft motion is probably not comprehensive yet.
Right.
That's what you do.
Well, so are we going to need to establish a fee tonight, or is that we're going to have a placeholder in there?
You don't have to, but I would suggest you do so the okay. applicant knows where they stand.
So we'll need
I
some additional motions.
You know.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we'll need to take a vote. Do we need to actually flesh those hours in our regulation, Dre? Would it be, or is that duplicative of the state rules? I don't know what your thinking is on whether you duplicate or not. It's clearer, but on the other hand, if one changes, well, I guess it doesn't have to change with state law.
Well, you have to decide whether you're going to do the, so state law establishes
right.
minimum hours, which Monday
right.
through Saturday is 11 to 11.
Oh, that's minimum, okay.
That's minimum.
Right. Okay.
And you have to decide whether you want
I see.
To,
yep.
mm-hmm. to allow openings
yeah. earlier and stay
earlier
open later.
And,
yeah.
and stay later. Now, we're talking about service of alcohol.
Right.
Hours, not necessary. I mean, some places open and don't serve alcohol until the license permits. And then there's, you know, so there's a limit. You can't go beyond
yep.
2 a.m. and you can't start earlier than 8 a.m. Okay.
Except on election day.
Is that a typo? At 11 to
2 11 to 2 p.m. Yeah,
it means 2 a.m.
I was just looking at
that.
That
is,
oh, yeah.
Yes, we mentioned that last time.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
got it.
Same memo, so it
still
has the same typo in it.
Still
has okay.
the same typo.
Yeah.
So really, what we're being asked to do is create a new category. I think that's
mm-hmm.
that's right.
I do think, you know, I think that's what the applicant, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it sounds like you don't want to open a restaurant. It sounds like you have a very specific way that you want to do this in a very specific place. Our problem at the moment is our current arrangement of the bylaw or of our liquor policy doesn't call for the right kind of license to match up to what the
right.
applicant is looking
exactly.
for. So I think what we're being asked to do is to create a category called general license. Is that right?
Well, that's
right.
created already. We
I mean,
just don't have any rules for it.
Well,
so
it's
that's
not
a
part
category
of our policy.
That's right. So that's a category that exists under
right.
the state regulations. But you have up till now had as your policy,
mm-hmm.
we don't offer that kind of
correct.
License.
So that's what we're being. I think that's what we're here
yes.
to consider.
Right.
Is yes, Barry. Go ahead.
No, I my question is, and I apologize for not being here last week, and so don't really necessarily understand the full scope of what we're being asked for, but. So is it my understanding that you want to do the painting at your location at the frame store and that's going to be at specific hours, you know, once a week, twice a month, PM. So after business hours of the frame store. So even though you could be open from 11 to 11, you don't plan on serving alcohol there when you're not doing the painting activity?
Correct, yeah. My store closes at 6.
Okay.
Her business starts at 6:01.
So that's an interesting topic you bring up. Are the two separate?
Hmm.
So we're granting this to the business, not
to
the store itself,
yeah.
right?
Well, it sounds like when the business, maybe I'm wrong about this, but let me just kind of frame out here. Let's assume for a minute that we had a general license category that had been embraced into our policy and established the appropriate fees as we saw them for that license. Would the applicant then apply for a license for the business that starts at 6:01? Or is it going to be a license that the framing store applies for? Is it, are the, follow what I'm saying?
Yes,
please.
Yes, please.
My name is Brad Latham, and if I could, I'm repeating some things, but for those who weren't here, perhaps I could, it might be better. It would be a separate entity in
yeah.
the same location that the husband's business, Judy, would offer.
The two businesses are sharing the location.
Sharing the same space.
Okay.
And I think these folks are responsible people, and I think conversely, the selectmen, while they've had the statutory authority to issue this license before, have shown that they are prepared to exercise discretion in the sense of saying no. So the fact, if you change your regulations and allow this particular use, which is very benign, I believe, this is not going to open floodgates. And if someone comes before you and you don't like it, you can just say the right to say no, as counsel would advise you. But the purpose here would be 3 hours while they have a function. That the artwork might be painting, it might be sculpturing, it might be wreath making during certain kinds of year. Demographically, you're dealing with women who are probably 35 to 50 or 60 years old and need to be there. You'd like to go,
especially if they're serving alcohol.
Here we go.
Mr. Berman's going to recuse himself.
So that's the objective. It's a very narrow use, and so our hope is that you would see that this would be appropriate and that you could control it appropriately. So you could limit the number of drinks that would be served to any particular participant. That's fine. You said you can limit the hours. I realize what council said in that regard. That's also fine. The only other request you'd make, if you're inclined to do this, is to consider what the license fee may be, because historically, this kind of a use does not generate the kind of money that a restaurant or a
sure.
bar generates, and maybe there could be some sensitivity. But that's pretty much what this is, and I think it would be a very nice use for the area. It's off hours. As I said last time, people may go there to paint or do whatever they're going to do, have a drink, and then go downtown for a meal afterwards. So it's a very symbiotic kind of use. Thank you.
Can I just ask a quick follow-up on
sure.
that? Ray can probably answer this. So there are two separate entities, they're two separate businesses.
That's correct.
One business is applying for the license, it doesn't apply to the other.
Exactly correct.
But it doesn't, I guess in the grand scheme of things, that one entity that's applying for the business could open up their business at 11.
We could, but actually I think generally you look for a copy of the lease or some sort of right of occupancy as far as the license application is concerned. And that lease could, in fact, restrict the hours of use if to the extent that gives any comfort.
Well,
is that true?
If we're going to issue the license,
okay.
I'm less worried about the hours of operation.
Well, the one thing that you need to just be clear on is that you have an applicant before you. You don't have an applicant before you yet, but you will have an applicant
right.
before you soon who is willing to restrict operations to certain hours. And you can put that into the license.
Their license.
Their license specifically. The problem comes when they decide, oh, this is really successful. We're going to skip the frame store. We want to start operating all day. And they come to you and say, now we used to want to just to operate from 6 to 11, but now we want to operate all day long. You can't refuse to allow that.
Right.
Why not?
State says you can't.
The state says you have to allow 11 to 11. So you can put in a license, and if they'll agree to it, it's in the license, and you can enforce it. But if they come to you and say, well, we don't like that limitation anymore, you'll have to extend it to 11.
And these licenses are renewed every year?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So let's say they do that, and our hands are tied. We can just not renew the license next year if we see.
You can't renew the license.
You kind of have to have a reason to not renew.
Well, because
I think going to what you're talking about,
we could
actually amend the policy again.
We had to renew Ricky's.
In other words, if we're allowing this license without food, we could always amend that policy down the line to require food. It's our policy, correct?
That is correct.
Okay.
Yes, you could do that.
So if there's an abuse of the license, you could always go back and say, well, we tried it, but now we're going to require food to maintain that license. And that would be the board's discretion.
You just can't change the hours.
Right. But you just can't touch the hours. Right. Okay.
I think the state law is there for a reason. I mean, they've picked times, and they say you can't limit it. Okay, fine. We're going to say that we're going to try to have a private negotiation as we issue this, but truth be known, Ray, you're telling us it's an 11 to 11 thing.
It will be, well,
should the business choose to do that?
Should the business agree to put it in the license, then the terms of the license prevail. But I'm just saying that should the business decide to expand at a later time, wants to run later, earlier hours, came to and said, we want our license to be amended to allow earlier hours, we pretty much have to give it to them.
Well, as I said a little earlier, my concern is not 11 to 11. If we think this is a proper kind of business to a license, then if we issue a liquor license and it turns into a booming business that is open from 11 to 11, if we agree to the license, I don't disagree with the statute that says what the times are. Logically speaking, I mean, I sort of get why at 6:01 is when this starts to happen. People are home from work, they want to go relax and do their hobby, and they want to have a glass of wine with that.
Well, absolutely.
That's kind of where I'm coming from on this. Barry?
I have a question on sort of how it works. Generally, someone will come in and they'd pay like a flat fee, and then we'd get their artist materials, and then maybe two tickets for a drink, or do you sell the drinks separately, and is there a limit, and does that mean you guys have to go through training to kind of do all that training stuff?
Just to back up a little, it's basically all done on the internet. People sign up ahead of time, so I will know in theory on Friday night I have 10 people coming in. I know on Saturday night I have 15. So that makes, that's the beauty of it. It makes the liquor very manageable and inventory very manageable. So they sign up ahead of time online. They come in, they usually come in a half hour before the class, and if the codes get situated, I present all the materials, we do a go over, and then I have a bar in the facility, but it's very small, again, accommodating those kind of numbers. And they walk up to the bar, and somebody is tending the bar, and we're already SIPS certified, and anybody else who works behind the bar will be SIPS certified, and they purchase a drink or a beer. And it's malt and wine. It's not all liquor, just to reinforce that too. So yes, they do come in. Then they might grab a glass of wine, sit down, and then we start a project. And then maybe another one. Usually the average is 1.5 a person. It's a 2 to 3 hour class. You're busy doing other things. And then it wraps up.
So in theory, anyone who comes in the door is already pre-registered. We have their name, a credit card number, an address that's associated with it. Mm-hmm. It's not really a walk-in business, so to speak.
Yeah, and you've got a tips-trained bartender who's going to card appropriately.
Yeah.
I'm guessing that's the plan.
And they pay separately for the drinks.
Yes.
So you can go there and choose not. So it's not like you get.
Oh yes.
Fee includes a drink or two. You can.
No.
Some people might not drink at all.
Right. Exactly. There'll be obviously non-alcoholic drinks too. Yes.
Bob, did I miss a question from you?
No, just a point that to step away from this potential applicant. Another important point is the selectmen are agreeing to a new category, which many different forms may come in and apply for a liquor license.
Right.
Under general, not just what they're doing, and you effectively created that category and agreed that 11 to 11 is the default time. So the board just should keep that in mind. And then council can advise you on how many licenses and what process you go through to
right.
say no and so
forth. So keep in mind this new category, it's called general, but what we're talking about is bars mostly. Yeah, is what's in this category. So currently you only license establishments that also have common victualler licenses.
Mm-hmm.
So they're essentially restaurants or close to restaurants.
Right.
So general licenses don't require service of food, and so that's the category that you're opening up. And within that category, you're making a special subcategory for places that have instructional classes.
Right.
But you you are opening up a category of potential licensees that do not serve food.
And we can't narrow that.
That's correct.
Okay.
So we can.
You, once you decide that you're going to issue licenses in this category, then that's what you're doing.
All right. Oh, go ahead.
Barry, you were first.
So a couple of things. And this doesn't really apply to you, but you're the first one in the door, so it gets us to think about this stuff. So two issues. One is that we have 10. We have 10 licenses. And
left.
And I think, I haven't talked to anybody here, but I think we would all be in agreement that we want to kind of reserve a chunk of those for the future economic development. So then we're working with a smaller number. Mm-hmm. Then the question becomes, is it, you know, how do we dispose of the other, let's say we want to hold six off. How do we dispose of the other four? Is it first one in the, you know, is it first come, first serve, number one? And then number two, general use. This on its niche is a great thing.
Yeah.
I mean, you have a downtown business that will be bringing more people into downtown. You know, we know you've run your business great for a long time, and you know maybe they will go to the Venetian Moon for a meal, or maybe they'll, you know, walk down to Papa Moose and get a bottle of wine to bring home. I mean, it's going to create life downtown, and that's something that everybody here, we've all agreed, is a good thing. So that sort of begs the question, is that if we're going to create another category, you know, sort of a general use, let's say the owner of Papa Moose, and I'm just making this up, she hasn't approached me, let's say she wanted on a Friday night to, you know, bring in a folk singer and have like a quote-unquote coffee house and sell wine. You know, again, more people coming in downtown, more business for her, keeps the doors open. Would that something that fall under the general? And she doesn't want, and she's not a victualler, although she does serve food there.
Yeah.
So, bad example.
But I mean, we're going to be trying to create these downtown businesses. Do we really want to be, you know, sort of think about who it is that we really kind of envision supporting doing this kind of stuff before they actually walk in the door? You guys are the first ones in. Because there's certain activities that in areas that we want to kind of support and keep traffic flowing and people moving downtown, and have enough of them that if there's, you know, interest to kind of do that without jeopardizing the liquor license we want to hold in reserve for future restaurants down the road. So is that,
let me ask
can
the
we
question
do that
a different way? How big a deal is it to raise the limits with the state? Is that a hard thing to do?
It could be a special act. Hmm. I don't know what you're expecting to happen in the next census,
hard to know.
That's right, we get one per 10,000, I think.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
We're not getting any more for that.
Okay, so, all right, so many towns go for a special act, they're routinely, you know, done, but you have to take it to town meeting and yet make the request. You know the deal for a special act.
Yeah.
That's when there's not, you can't like apply to the ABCC for a permission to issue more.
So I think the frontal approach to what I think my two friends here are asking is, do we have the ability? I guess we're the liquor commissioners as well as being the Board of Selectmen. So if that's the case, is there anything that stops us from saying either yes or no? Just because we issue one, does that mean we have to issue 10? So get right back to you, Dan.
Example. Yeah.
Okay. So here's the deal.
Okay.
Each liquor license, you need to make a finding that the issuance of this liquor license serves a public need. That's the legal phrase.
Mm-hmm.
Public need. Many towns have an idea like you do that, you know, they prefer these licenses to go to restaurants rather than bars.
Mm-hmm.
Or that they prefer that they go to the downtown area rather than other have areas, or vice versa, that they prefer got enough in the downtown area, we want them someplace else. You can, so when you're ruling on a license application, each and every time, you have the ability to say, this does or does not serve the public need. So, what I would just encourage you to do is to make sure that when you make a decision, you say something about the public need in the decision, so that if somebody appeals it, the ABCC won't overturn it. But it certainly, if you make a finding that the public need is better served by reserving, you know, 6 licenses for future restaurants, and therefore you can't issue this one, and then maybe better not to do both, but push came to shove. Or if you decide you've got enough of these kinds of uses you don't really want to issue any more licenses to people who aren't operating, you know, a full 11 to 11, you can do that. But what you need to do is each time make a finding about what the public need is. And so you are certainly under no obligation to issue any more licenses of this type or any other bar licenses at all.
Okay.
General licenses.
We determine that the public need is not being served by such
by issuing them. That's right. But you need to be able to say why it's not. And so just we don't like bars is not going to be good enough.
Right.
But saying, you know, we want to hold these out for restaurants because we think the restaurants better serve
the economic development of the town already.
We have an economic development plan that says so.
Yeah.
Okay.
That answers my question.
But you need to make the finding each and every time. This isn't something that you can say, well, we have a policy and then we're done.
Well, I think we have to consider here, when if this board makes such a decision to add this category to our policy, it's important that the advice you've given us stays front and center. Because
it's always important for the advice I give to stay front and center.
Well, what I'm saying is, what about 5 years from now? This could be, there could be 5 different people on this board.
Yeah. But I'll still be here.
Okay, Your Honor. I didn't realize you'd become, you know, a Supreme Court justice, that you were going to be here forever.
So, no, you're right. And it's important for future boards of selectmen to keep in mind what the standard is and what's being advised, even if they might have a different idea of what is the public need.
So let me just ask you another quick question here. I think we agree, and I think you've advised us, that this is a way to solve this problem in this current application process. However, it's your opinion that our policy is poorly written.
Well, let's say it's out of date.
Okay, that's a nice way to say that it's
he
poorly
lets us
written.
Down
so
easy,
we'll call it
yeah.
out of date.
Okay.
So I guess what I'd just like to go on record as saying is that when we rewrite it, and since I'm assuming, since you're going to be here forever, that you'll be
and
part
I'm
of that.
Get
started writing it.
We need to, that I'm going to just say, I personally think we need to have written into our policy something about our obligations concerning the public need.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
sure.
As we, I just think that would be an important addition.
Yeah.
That way, each board, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, or until
mm-hmm.
that policy gets out of date, and of course you'll still be here.
Still be
you'll be able to be sure that the public need
or your heirs are assigned
so topic right. stays stays near and dear to the policy of the liquor policy of the selectmen. I just think that's important.
Yeah.
Because I think it does the things that you're
yeah.
that we're all talking about here.
We want to support people being creative and
yeah.
entrepreneurial
yes.
and create activity downtown. On the other hand, we don't want that to be the focus of our economic.
Well, it's got to be bigger than that.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a nice idea for a nice additional business, but if we're able to add 5 or 6 restaurants, of, you know, substantial nature that turn us into a dining hub. Which is economically, from an economic development standpoint, you know, and which is what, that's actually what all the studies have told us, is that the more of these restaurants you cluster, the larger the, the flow and the larger the economic development impact is. So I just think that as long as we get a policy written that properly lays out our duties and obligations, so that we can preserve what we need to preserve, then I think we can go forward with something like this.
Okay, we'll get to work.
Okay.
But we don't have to do that before we act on this.
No, that's
later.
That's the whole idea here.
Yeah, later on. We're gonna,
well, I'm just saying it out loud to the guy that's here forever.
Yeah, we can add this to the already out of date policy.
Yes.
Yeah, this is designed to.
Is there other questions or comments from the board or the public?
I just want to make one comment. I know you're not applicants technically in front of us tonight, but it sounds like the good chance you could be soon. None of the comments tonight, just so you know, are based towards you. I think, you know, as Barry said, first in the door, this board is always taking a very cautious approach when it comes to liquor licenses in this town. So I also wanted to go on record as saying a good friend of yours, who I trust thoroughly, had wrote me a nice note saying that these are the two of the nicest people you'll ever meet, two of the most honest people you'll ever meet. So I wanted to make that as part of a public record. Brooke Chipman speaks very highly of you. So,
well, if you follow our history in dealing with liquor licenses, you find that we're very supportive of those people that do what they're supposed to do, and right. We are the worst thing that ever happened to somebody that doesn't.
Right.
I mean, that's just kind of the way we've approached it as a group. And I personally think that's a good way to approach it.
Yep.
So, it seems like we need to get moving on the stuff in front of us here, and I'm going to assume for a minute, if we follow the bouncing ball on our notes, that these motions will take us to a change in our liquor policy.
Just the motion just be section 3.2 and not 3.2.4, capture every fees.
And we have to establish,
so we
yeah,
have to
right?
establish the fees.
Do we do that
is,
tonight?
Is there anything else
yes,
we need
I
to?
Yes, we should.
Yeah, let me ask. So if we pass this motion, will you know how to rewrite 3.2?
You will. We'll be here forever.
But you don't know what we want
for
hours.
Take
forever. You don't.
No.
You don't know
no,
what
you
want
have
for
to tell. You have to tell me what
tonight.
You want for hours.
Tonight.
What you want for hours.
Okay.
And what you want for fees.
So we need to entertain a discussion
yeah.
about that under these two items.
About
my
the
feeling
fees
is
and the hours.
My feeling on the. At the moment, is the 11-11 is just fine.
Yeah, I'm okay with it.
Yeah,
I mean, that's
I'm,
what the law
I'm fine with that
board.
As well too.
Yeah.
I'd coincide that with state.
And you could either close on you can't close on Sunday, right? Because it's or can you?
No, you can just the
license would allow it.
Would allow them to be open on
oh,
Sunday.
Yeah.
Okay. The minimum hours. Okay. 10 to 1.
So,
yeah. So, is the board thinking 11-11 Monday through Saturday and 10 a.m. through 1 a.m. Sunday?
My feeling is we can't, the state law doesn't allow us to limit it beyond that. So, I
think. No, we can't, but we can put that into our bylaws. We're not going beyond that, what the state requires. If you want.
That would be, for this general license, that would be my initial
yeah.
approval.
Yeah.
That would be my suggestion.
To adopt the Mass General Laws?
Yeah, what a concept that we'd actually adopt
that,
the
huh?
law as part of our policy.
So is that okay, just a sense of the board in addition to the motion? Okay. How about fees?
Does anybody else disagree
yeah.
or?
No.
No, I mean, we're not gonna, same thing like it was the hunting stuff. We couldn't change it because it was already in state law.
Correct.
So
that,
okay.
That's
so
where I'm coming from.
We're going 11-11, 7 days a week, right?
Don't we have to go 12?
Doesn't Sunday?
No, I think you have to do Sunday differently, don't you?
Sunday
is different.
What's the state have for Sunday, right?
You can go 10 a.m. to 1 a.m.
You can drink earlier on Sunday.
You can, but you can limit it from.
You can still go 11 to 1.
My proposal is 11-11, 7 days a week.
All right.
I mean, it seems like that's congruous with the state. We're not getting.
Oh, within the board's discretion. I misread that.
Yeah, I mean, we're not getting ourselves in any trouble with.
That's fine.
Minimums, laid out by the state.
Yeah.
We're creating a new category of general licensing.
That's right.
It's not our goal really to put, you know, bars out there. It's our goal to look at each individual situation, and this, I think we're looking at this one and finding it to be a good one, but they haven't even really applied yet. So we're just about the business now of straightening out our bylaw, correct?
Yes.
Correct.
What else do we need to do other than
talk about fees?
Fees.
Fees.
So, you know, I've
what are the fees for?
I've looked at some. I've done some research on the fees.
Yeah.
And
what do you got?
You know, when you look at there are several categories of fees, and they're also tied to whether you're serving malt and wine or whether you're serving full liquor, and some of those can get substantial. Do I have $2,500 in my head as a fee for a restaurant?
I'll get it here. It's something.
No, there it is. Okay.
Is that big enough to read?
Yep. Well,
close enough
for me.
It's far enough away. That's what's the important thing is at this time. So a retail package is $2,500. A restaurant license is
$37. $37 all alcohol, $2,700 malt.
And clubs are $1,300.
In your policies, you should have all alcohol and malt and wine as two prices.
Two separate ones.
You could price them the same. But
so for example, if we were to, let me just say, if we had a malt and wine at $1,000 for this category and $1,300 for a full license, would that make some sense given what's going on here? I mean, it's substantially less than a restaurant.
It is, but it still seems high to me.
Yeah.
For a business like this.
For a business like this,
it's their main. I mean, and they're open
the
a couple hours.
Really.
Well, let's not forget that, you know, alcohol, you know, brings with it certain public safety issues that create certain costs to the town. I mean, that's just a fact. I'm not trying to, you know, I'm not trying to game revenue here. I'm just trying to, every time we look at a fee, it better justify the costs involved, and there are certain public safety costs involved in, you know, in a liquor license. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, so you're absolutely right. In fact, state law requires fees to be set to be roughly commensurate with the cost of providing the service.
Yep.
So in the case of liquor license, the cost of providing the service is the cost of issuing a license, but it's also the cost of that the town incurs in
public safety.
Connection with public safety. So you're absolutely right. Whether you want general licensees to as a general matter, to pay less than restaurants is completely up to you. I mean, you could conclude that the cost of the town are the same or even more for a general license than for a restaurant. You could conclude that.
Yes.
I'll let you think on that. You also could establish a different fee for this kind of specialized license.
But we'd have to have that license. We'd have to have that application in front of us to make such a decision. We don't have such an application.
No, but you could establish a category that category. You are already establishing a category in the regulations for commercial establishments that provide instructional classes.
Right.
So you could establish a separate fee.
Does it have to be a fee, or can it be a range of fees? Maybe depending on the size of the enterprise.
Oh, you could do it based on the size of the enterprise. Sure, you could.
Do we have any idea what, as a percentage of revenues, the restaurants pay?
No idea.
We don't do anything like that now.
No.
I'm just saying, as a ballpark guidance, to see if $1,000 makes sense, or $100, or $300. I know it's somewhere down in there, I think, rather than.
Look, I mean, Ray, I think you make a good point. I mean, one could argue that what we're doing here is creating a general license that could in fact, either this board or some other board could allow a bar to open, and the cost of public safety could far outreach that of a restaurant. Now, I'm not suggesting that that's what this situation is at all. I'm just trying to come up with a number that actually makes some reasonable sense in light of other fees that we have, because I'm going to take a leap and say that our other fees are reasonably in line. We've gotten, I don't believe, any complaints or petitions for as we've renewed licenses over the last several years that I've been involved, we've gotten no request for relief from those fees. So let me assume that those are reasonable and customary by comparison. Now we're talking about a general license, and particularly what's brought this to light would make me want to say, let's look at this at a smaller number than these, because I do think it does make sense to let it be smaller, especially in light of the application we expect to be seeing. But what's the right number? I mean, this is a liquor license. I mean, I don't want to put a fee at a place that, first of all, doesn't cover our costs, and secondly, is an inducement for everybody to take a flyer at this. I mean, the potential applicants have put a lot of time and energy and effort into researching this and preparing for this, and frankly, if we suddenly open the doors and everybody goes, let me take a shot too, mm-hmm. and you know, yeah, and so there's no barrier to entry, I guess is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Then we're going to sit in here worried about the public need for how many of these places. Yeah, Bob.
I could ask Ray a question. So right now the board should set fees for general all alcohol. Subcategory general instructional classes. They have to do two of those also, or could they limit it to only malt and wine?
Probably would have. You should do both, because you could conceivably have somebody that's going to be serving, you know, looking to serve all alcohol. You should probably do.
So you're suggesting we consider a subcategory.
That's an interesting suggestion. Yeah. So I think, to maybe getting back to the point what you're talking about, for somebody like a bar who would fall under a general all alcohol or beer and wine, that could be a higher fee than something of an instructional general license. Is that what you're suggesting, Bob?
I would think so.
Yes.
I would think a bar can come in under the general
they
category.
Could, so you want to be able to guard against.
And so we'd want to be able to have a high fee. I mean, one would argue that.
So
in that regard, one would argue that 37 is maybe not high enough to make sure.
Remember,
to
you shouldn't be setting fees on the basis of
barrier
to entry. You're supposed to make them commensurate with your
Well, we already know that a restaurant
supposed to abound
to serving food from a
okay
is gonna
thank you
is a essentially a $3,700
Right, that's
it,
the most expensive.
Like a safe place to start is just copy the restaurants.
Yeah, that's
it
what
does.
I think too. So
yeah.
If we
you learn over time whether
so if we create a general license,
mm-hmm.
and that general license has a mirror of
37, 27,
and then we have a subcategory
mm-hmm.
for instructional locations under the general license, and it's a, you know, maybe it's a $600 and $800
yeah.
fee
that
that's, you know suddenly
yeah.
now
yeah.
is a little more commensurate with. It's serious. It's alcohol,
mm-hmm.
but you know you're not. You're trying to hold the line so a small business isn't being penalized by excessively high fees. And there is a reality that public safety is not going to be as demanded in a setting like, I think, you know, back to your point, Ray, of, you know, what's it really cost?
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean that, you know, the chief isn't going to send somebody in to visit and make sure that you're doing it right, because he will. I mean, that's what we do in this town. And that's, there's a certain cost to doing business to that. Huh?
But maybe not every day.
Correct. Not every day, but we will judge their artwork.
And they do have plenty of parking.
Yeah. They won't be parking a cruiser with that. No.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Chairman, we have a lot of loose ends here, and we're going to clearly need to see a redrafted Section 3.2, I think, before we could. You agree before we could take a really final vote on this? I don't know what it's going to look like yet. I can't say I'm really voting on to approve revisions until the revisions are in a document and I've looked at it.
Well, I'm certainly open to that discussion, but it seems to me that what we're trying.
Provisional.
I think what we're doing is expanding a new category in Reading of a general license.
I understand that. That's not my point.
What is your point?
My point is, we don't have the verbiage we're voting on.
I can take you through it. Have it behind me. Section 3.2, you would add this category here, general on premises licenses at the bottom. Section 3.2.1.20, you just discussed the hours of operation.
Right.
So we'll just limit it to the ones that the state has 11 to 11.
Are you gonna take out?
You will remove section 3.2.4.5, which is the old thing that prior town council has suggested to accommodate this. And add this new section 3.2.7. As written.
All right, I guess that's simple. It's just really the fee table.
And then it's, the fee is a separate one. That's in a different section that I'm sure you're on.
We don't know what we want there yet.
And you'll have to discuss under 3.2.1.19 what the fees are. So I don't think it's a, I understand your point. You like to see it all, but it's kind of here and there.
We're adding four columns to that chart. In our, based on the last.
Can we just put TBD in there and then take another crack at it when we've thought about it some more? In the four columns. We don't know. Do you really know what those numbers should be tonight?
The fees?
Yeah.
I think I do.
Yeah, right. I mean, it's.
Well, if you want to propose something, sure.
I mean, only because my take on this would be, we've opened a new category.
Right.
If we had a bar that wasn't serving food, I can't imagine it would cost us less from a public safety standpoint to administer that as it would a restaurant.
Oh, yeah.
With a bar. So my suggestion would be that the general category be 37 and 27.
Mm-hmm.
To mirror that.
Right.
Given our fourth category that we're proposing, which is back to that grid.
Yeah, instructional classes.
Instructional classes.
For the two.
For the two. I mean, right now clubs pay $1,300.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, does it seem, clubs are however are open.
A lot more often.
Yeah,
a lot
bigger.
More, serving a lot more people.
I mean, Meadowbrook.
Well, we only have a certain amount of club licenses.
One or two.
Like the VFW, isn't that one?
Yeah, I would guess the American Legion is too, but I don't know that. But the point is, to me, you come up with a fee that actually, you know, is substantial because there are expenses involved from a public safety standpoint, but try to be reasonable given the amount of opening. Whether it's 5 or 6 and 7 or 8 or, you know.
How about 4 and 6? 400, 600.
Well, is there any, you know, I'm very much a fan of trying to, you know, make it as feasible as possible for a new business, but is there any train of thought to keep it almost what you said in the beginning with 1,000, 1,300? So you don't have all these club licenses jumping to the instructional.
Oh, yeah.
Our facilities now and doing it under that guise. I know that's kind of a strange thought, and probably would take someone
to
really try to.
Could they do that?
They'd have to reapply.
And remember.
And give up their club license.
Public
they
need.
They can only purchase alcohol if they're enrolled in the class. So they've got to be classes.
Beer drinking.
I think we're reaching around here.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think we have to have a fourth. My opinion is, and there's four of us here, so it's not.
Yeah.
I like the idea of a smaller number for, you know, each the, you know, malt and I mean, I'm open to the discussion somewhere in that range of $400 to $600 for the malt and wine license. I think that's not an unreasonable thing. It's very different than a business license, but you're serving alcohol.
Right.
So, you know, it needs to be different, I think.
All right, split the difference, 500 for the malt?
Yeah.
Add 2 for the other?
Yep.
500, 700?
Sounds good to me.
500, 700?
Going once?
I'm good with 500, 700.
Put it in. I guess my concerns are alleviated.
Let's try to understand for the secretary what we just did.
Yeah, that's probably a better idea.
Yeah, you should probably close the hearing.
Oh, yes.
Okay, move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on amending.
Well, wait, should we ask any public comment before we do that? Sorry.
Give me a final shot.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Any more comment?
Okay, sorry to cut you off.
All right. Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on amending Section 3.2.4
of the Board of Selectmen liquor license policies.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 4-0, Paul.
I'd suggest the next motion is move the Board of Selectmen revise section 3.2 of the Board of Selectmen liquor license policies as indicated in the memo from Town Council to the Town Manager dated February 23rd, 2016. With the hours limitation of 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. and then the fees that you just described.
Mm-hmm.
General license, all alcohol, 3,700, general license, wine and malt, 2,700, general license, instructional classes, all liquor, 700,
mm-hmm.
general license, instructional classes, wine and malt, 500.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Second.
I'll send that to Paula.
I have it.
Okay.
Secretary just made that motion.
Oh.
Second.
I didn't make it.
Discussion.
By reference.
Right.
It's good with me. Good with me.
All in favor? Opposed? 4-0, Paula.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for putting this
we'll
in front of us.
We'll be seeing
you
soon.
So now we
guys follow us around the mulberry bush there?
All right. Thank
all
you.
Right, take care.
Okay. That's, I think we need to move on to the approval of the March 22nd meeting.
Yep.
Minutes.
Yep.
Thank you, Ray.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening, Ray.
You're
going
to be here forever. You're going to stay till we leave. That's like,
oh, very good. I'll make, one of you guys should make the motion, probably.
Move
you can make the motion. You don't have to vote for it.
Yeah, that's true.
I will be the third vote, by the way, because I did watch the meeting in its entirety, so I feel I'm a good place to understand that the minutes are right.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes March 22nd, 2016 as amended.
Seconded.
Okay. Discussion?
That looks pretty good.
All those in favor? Opposed? Abstentions?
301.
301, Paula.
Yep.
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at...
Right on the number.
10...
Chairman,
10 o'clock, yeah.
Stand.
See
10
that?
10 bells.
See?
Seconded.
Discussion? All those in favor?
All right. Fade to black.
I don't know what I did with the original.
There is a letter that is probably not in your packet. It's going off to our representatives. Could I ask you to forward that? Or maybe Matt can, either one. It's a letter endorsing a certain bill that's going on.
I think it was in the packet.
Was it? I don't think
it
was.
It was in the Paula packet.
Yeah.
It was in the Paula packet, but I don't know if you're getting that electronically yet. I know we had discussed that.
On the website.